Chapter 18. Dad barely crossed my mind since riding away from Porto Oda. But then, by the light of the fire, Zamora shows me the minute signature inscribed on the eye. Seeing his name affects me as it did every time I saw it on his cap. But it's not the name so much, but the intricate etching Will J, undoubtedly his, matching the one on his shed's lock, that brings him back. Suddenly, I feel him creak the barn doors open, walk in ever so calmly, and sit down on the chair beside me, enjoying the heat of the crackling flames. His working hands and sweaty brow concentrating, while the faithful scent of fish and blood lingers on his pants. Only my desire to keep his memory here prevents me from falling into a pile of rubble like the broken box pieces in the corner. I shut my eyes, breathing slowly and deeply, and remember the night he sat by our fire at home, stitching his name into the back of his cap. I tugged his pants and asked, "What are you doing?" "God always remembers us," he said. "But I write my name so you'll always remember me too." Then with each slow breath, his presence fades as he gets up from the chair and walks from the barn. The door groans as he shuts it behind him, followed by the clunk from the lock. "David said someone inscribed his name on the eye," I say to Zamora. "It was my father." "Sorry," Zamora says, asking for more information. "David explained the compass's origin," I say. "My father must have been one of the eye's engineers, the last one who finished it with Veni, the one who was desperate for it." Zamora seems perplexed, then asks, "Your father was an engineer?" "Seems that way," I say, eyes unblinking. "But how could Dad be? He was always clever with his hands, at making things. Maybe he kept science materials locked in his shed." Zamora falls silent, and my last thought is just for myself. Did my father join the council for our family, or leave Mom and I for some grand purpose? He's always kept part of him a mystery. My head begins throbbing, spinning like a beanskin spun by a child, as I contemplate a horrific possibility. The last scientist who worked with Vinny on the compass wanted to keep it for himself, and I suspected at first it was that scientist who killed her. So maybe it wasn't an Ipianian who killed Vinny, maybe it was Dad. Zamora stands beside me, compassion in her eyes. "Do you think it means he's safe?" I look at her, trying to think but drawing only a blank. "He could have killed the woman who finished this compass. How could you think such horrors?" Zamora asks. "From what I heard from David." "Are you sure?" I shake my head. "No. But if he is alive, he'll be searching for the heart." "Maybe if we found the heart," Zamora says, with empathy controlling her voice, "we would find your father and learn that he is no murderer?" I don't answer because I don't know. But I smile. A smile is never a lie. The rhythm of the rain eases into a fine mist and then ends as it gives way to the gales, and our clothes are dry and baked warm, hanging by the fire. The bustling wind should soon part the clouds and reveal the stars, which can be a sure guide to Porto Oda. Although it has been a break from all things oh so stressful in this little brick enclosure, the reality is if Flipple tracked us, maybe the others will. And before long Aletta will reach that town and discover we didn't go there and resume her search. It's time to leave the mill in peace and let its water wheel be alone in its churning of the river. Readying to dress in our normal clothes, I grab my drawers to furtively slip them on underneath the wheat sack. Unfortunately, Zamora spots the frilly underwear dangling in my hands. "What's that?" She points at them. "Man drawers." I whip them behind my wheat sack covered back. "Was there," her face wrinkles in discernment, "frills on them or lace? How could she spot that in this shadow-ridden mill?" "They're just torn," I say. "They got ripped fighting. They looked lacy. Show me." Zamora sticks out her egotistical hand. "Sorry, sweetcake, a man's drawers are sacred," I say and stand firm. The girl moves toward me while I take retreating caterpillar steps. Better think of something to keep her away. It will ruin my reputation if she sees Aletta's drawers. "Besides, you wouldn't want to touch them," I say. "They've been soiled. I got a bit scared earlier, and no, I wasn't scared, I just couldn't hang on and didn't have anything to wipe with, so." "Oh yuck, kid." Zamora turns her nose. The old soiled drawers placebo scared her off. So easy to fool a girl, sometimes. I turned from Zamora, holding my soft frillies, ready to slip them on. Hum da dum da da, I sing in glee, lift a little foot, hold my drawers under my toes. Zamora jumps on me with her full body weight, and we tumble to the ground, rolling and tussling along the bricks. She reaches with her reachy arms, grasps with her grabbing hands, extends all her limbs desperate to snag my drawers. Fingers scratch, arms and legs flip and flap. My biceps flex with fury, Zamora's quiver with weakness, and in the end. Get off me, I say, lying flat out like a sun-dried starfish, with Zamora sitting on my belly, pinning my arm under my back. Zamora dangles my frilly drawers over my nose like a bully teasing, then inspects them, running the fabric through her fingers. These are lacy and frilly. She'll think I'm wimpy. Everything is ruined. But then Cheval's clever excuse for his night suit speaks to me. The cottony frills let the skin breathe, I say and reach for them, but she snatches the underwear away. Lets you breathe or lets you file your nails, she says, edging up an eyebrow which would be enjoyable to file off. My nails are jagged, I say, better for picking your just give back my drawers. I go to grab them, but Zamora slams my wrist to the ground, sinking the pointy part of her knee into it. Breaking free from this mad woman would be the less humiliating option, but perhaps it's best not to struggle, because a failed attempt at escape will leave her picking on me more so. It's okay if you like ladies' drawers, Zamora says, and plunks them flat on my face and scruffs them over my lips, they better not be soiled, and then climbs off. Glad to have the girl's weight removed, I stand and rub my smarting wrist. She gazes at me as if I depict the hallmarks of a weakling, and so I say, your knee was pointy. Having finished humiliating me, Zamora cheerily dresses in a dark corner, while I angrily rip my clothes on in another and get my stupid sleeve caught. Get on damn sleeve, I grumble, anger and frustration overflowing after being beaten up by a girl. But calmness comes when upon noticing the sleeve end I cut off on the wall with Cheval, and feel pride in my escape move. David would have been impressed. That sees me snap on my linen pants. They actually feel restrictive. The free breeze of the wheat sack was liberating. I open the mill's doors to the clouds being broken apart by the stiff winds, showing a glimpse of Sirius's blue glow. Although it is a guiding light, it sends little shivers of nerves through me, because it means we have to head out of here through the jungle, and because Jago hasn't arrived yet. Zamora positions herself beside me, while I whistle again. Whipped. Zamora yanks my hand down, ripping my fingers from my whistleless mouth. She makes a circle with her thumb and middle finger and, wheat. My ears ring. Zamora raises her hands, as if to imply whistling is a sink. Whistle. I'm trying to. A sudden pang attacks me as a noise disturbs the air, something sludging in the mud, a slow glopping slush-slush-like footsteps perhaps. Zamora and I, having both fallen silent, slowly draw our faces toward one another and stare into each other's eyes, both of us listening. It could be a cow. Glop slush, the strange steps ripple again and grow a little louder. Whatever it is, it's creeping toward us from around the side of the mill. A broad shadow appears over the wet mud, edging from the corner wall, and a moment later the wind sends a pernicious wave of the stench of wet fur. In shock, I take a step back, and Zamora's fists clench, as if she's thinking about punching whatever it is. But the bulk of that shadow clearly shows this animal will not be tamed with a punch. Is this the shadow you saw when the window broke? Zamora whispers ever so quietly. What rattled the roof? A shrug of my shoulder suggests it doesn't really matter, and I touch her arm and murmur, get inside the mill. Where? A black gorilla roars from the dark and charges us in a flash of bounding fur, spanking a huge arm across both of our bodies and smacking us into the mud. The hit felt like falling from a horse. He's knocked us past the doorway which he blocks with his menacing boulder-type frame. With little other place to retreat, we crawl back against the callous bricks of the mill. It's not the mother with the baby on its back that spied on us as we trailed here through the jungle. This male is bigger. The powerful great ape with a bulky head, bulging brow ridge, and stout neck breathes a heavy hiss, considering whether to pull us apart with its giant arms. The beast stoops, muscle-bound as if its body is rocks stacked upon rocks. He's breathing heavily, shaggy copper-black fur hanging off its neck and shoulders, flowing in the wind like a mane, its eyes brown and ringed by a black iris and glistening with anger, legs poised to pounce and feet and hands sunk firmly into the mud, mud that is gripped by claws, every fiber of the beast threatening. Its jaws perhaps most frightening, a black muzzle of teeth as spiked and sharp as any knife, face drawn into a disturbed grimace. The gorilla seems to have elements of a lion, like in Chaval's drawings. The brick mill braces against our backs, our boots squishing in the mire. Fear cannot quite take me, because shock has already filled that space. Then, finally, my nerves begin to settle and I notice he's holding a strip of white cotton smeared in mud. He's holding my shirt sleeve. How did that thing get my shirt sleeve? I ask. Oh, the gorilla roars, a wide display of teeth protruding from his pink gums. The ape arches his back and drops my sleeve, and returns to grinding his hands into the wet clay. The beast takes a few lumbering paws forward, and as if in a frightened dance, we take a few back, the gorilla's teeth glinting more with each glimmer of light that strikes them through the parting clouds. I reach for the dagger in my boot, but realize the stupid thing is lying on the floor beside the bean cans. A lesson learned in messiness. Zamora and I are hopeless before the beast, as if two convicted criminals about to be hung. Or worse, the guillotine. That creature must not get his hands on us, or we could have a limb torn off. Beside my foot lies the branch I flung away from the door before we entered the barn, but it will be of little use against a menace of 500 pounds. Maybe I could jam it somewhere, somewhere he wouldn't like very much, but that's about it. I slowly reach down, my eyes on the beast's eyes following my hand. I grab the stick. The gorilla grumbles over my weapon and braces itself, its muscle-encased body pulling taut. I really don't want to try jamming this stick anywhere. Zamora whispers, no sudden movements or it will. I throw the branch into the gorilla's face. Run. The wall is left with the trail of our boots spitting mud as we flee around the corner with our boots slipping on the mix of wet grass and sludge, the creature roaring like it believes it is a lion scaring us into a confused frenzy. Our dash takes us to the rear of the mill to where the river is flowing, and we jump onto the wooden water wheel in a clattering crash. We find our footing and handholds on the giant wheel and begin to climb the parts of the contraption, but our weight slowly pulls the paddles down toward the river, scooping up cold water. The gorilla roars again, its voice traveling out from behind the mill. The thump-thump of his hands follows, accompanied by feet thudding through the mire. Those giant arms are upon us, I say in a tone shakier than any surrounding windswept leaves. Gripped with fear, we crawl an awkward path through the center of the wheel frame, bumping our heads and whacking our knuckles on pieces of timber until resting in the middle. The gorilla bounds around the corner and catches us with his eyes. Nostrils widen and contract, eyes narrow. When it comes for us, I say to Zamora, and she replies, don't say that, and I respond forcefully, it will. And when it does, scramble to the paddles behind. The gorilla charges and leaps forward, an impressive flight through the air, arms and legs outstretched. We clamber toward the other side of the wheel. The brute lands its huge frame on the water wheel in a terrific crash, rattling near all the pieces. We cling to the far paddles, and the beast's weight pulls him down toward the water, and in turn swings us upward on the rotating wheel, as if on a ride in some crazy circus. It allows us to grab the roof and scramble up in an array of flailing arms, legs, and hands, hands that may or may not have accidentally gripped someone's hair. You nearly yanked my hair out, Zamora says, adjusting it. It was may have gripped someone's hair. It tangled around my arm, I say, and she glowers almost as viciously as the gorilla. Then mine and Zamora's eyes leave off our gaze and are drawn to our main concern at the bottom of the water wheel, the copper-backed gorilla. It stands its feet back on level ground while its huge arms rest up against the wheel. The monster takes a moment to stare upward, intent on our blood. The ape, not content to paw away into the jungle, begins to crawl into the paddles again in another attempt to climb after us, but the wheel's paddles swing him down once more for a dip in the river. He can't get up because the paddles just keep him falling. A huge breath of air that could fill any such paddle escapes my lungs. We're safe upon the roof, I say. While the gorilla holds the frame with one hand, it launches into a powerful swing into the center of the wheel structure and sets those brown eyes on me, brown eyes that seem to say climbing is one of my specialties, and it begins scaling up the center. Safe for 3 more seconds. That beast is mountaineering up the wheel, quicker than a lion chasing a monkey up a tree. And once it's upon the roof of the mill, there is either the option of punching it square in its teeth-riddled mouth or leaping from the mill back to the ground, and at this height it's most likely will break an ankle. Thick branches lie scattered on the roof's iron sheets, blown from the storm. One that is twice as thick as Bennett's walking cane dares me to take it, so I do. The gorilla pokes his head up over the roof's edge, two large nostrils widening and breathing in our scent, two eyes beaming. I swing away. The branch snaps over the gorilla's head with a crack that echoes like a clap of thunder. The hit was hard enough to knock out any soldier, as cold as a stump. But the gorilla does not do what I hoped. He does not faint into unconsciousness, and does not tumble down through the paddles in clattering and flailing body parts and splash into the water. Instead, he goes still, face pouting as if a restless child brooding aggravation before an uncontrolled outburst. Why in the hell did I hit it over the head with a stick? Blood trickles from a cut on its forehead, a line of red like a fork of lightning seeping down his skin of black leather, all the wound my best effort could inflict. He slowly raises his eyes in creepy millimeters, sliding his gaze from my boots to up over my pants and my cardigan until he locks those deep earthy browns on me. Where? He screams, and slobber flies from his mouth and splashes across my cardigan in dripping chunks, sending with it his thick breath. Smells like fish. Zamora bumps beside me. You made it angrier. That's an acquired skill I have with animals, I say, then point over the apex frame of the roof. To the other side. We run, sliding on the wet and slippery iron sheets, knocking useless for nothing weapon branches away with our feet and cross the peak. I glance back as the gorilla ascends onto the roof, pulling his heavy body up like it weighed as much as a bag of feathers. We scale down the other side of the apex, slip and slide on the wet tree leaf riddled iron sheets, and fall onto our backsides where we continue to slide, heading for the edge and a smack onto the ground causing broken ankles, and so I call, grab the gutter. In a flash, we flip over the roof's edge, the muddy earth a descent drop. But with a nifty swing of our arms, we grasp the guttering, which pops loose and jerks and lowers the fall, then busts completely away from the edge of the roof and dumps us into the mud. It's a heavy plunge where we clatter over one another, with arms over legs and legs over stomachs. A quick glance into each other's eyes shows, despite being tangled into one another like a plate of spaghetti, we are not injured because the guttering slowed the plummet. Into the mill, I say, and Zamora pulls her legs out from under my arms, and I flip my legs from over her stomach, and we get up and scramble inside, barging into each other's bodies as we squeeze through the doorway. I quickly turn and slam the door shut, grab the iron lock, ready to jam it in the solid ring, when the doors bash open right into me in a bursting rush. They fling me back into Zamora, knocking us down. The gorilla takes a defiant stance in the doorway, blood dripping from the cut above his eye, steam rising from his shoulders as light silhouettes off his massive frame. Four brick walls of the mill surround us, blocking any path to run. Zamora and I carefully slide backward on the ground, away from the monster, not daring to jump up. He beats his leathery gorilla breast with one arm, a thump thump thump, the beats almost feeling like they're punching my chest. He drops open his mouth, and his pinkish tongue slivers out as he releases an enormous "ruah," the howl reverberating through the mill and rattling the unbroken windows as if they're frightened themselves. His pounding fists are going to match his scream, Zamora says. Her words are painfully true. If that roar is terrifying, those leathery hands thrashing us will be unimaginable. Fighting the brute is the only choice. I need my dagger, I whisper, hoping my voice doesn't send the gorilla into a frenzied attack. I scan for it on the ground in the shadows of the red brick floor, but the damn darkness keeps it concealed. If you wield a knife, Zamora whispers, he'll grab your wrist and snap it. Most likely. We have to try evade this brute. Perhaps draw him inside the mill and lure him toward the back, then dash around him and escape out the doors. Where to run after that? Deal with that in the unlikely event we make it out without the gorilla pounding our heads into squashed bean cans. I slowly get to my feet along with Zamora, and we take a few retreating steps. The gorilla remains firm. He doesn't seem to be following, Zamora says. Tackling this animal in a bear hug is never going to work, and both of us cannot face his attack, so for perhaps some slight protection for Zamora, I edge my feet in front of her. Only thing now, between Zamora and a 500-pound beast, is a 150-pound scarred to death young man. The gorilla arches his big shoulders, clearly showing his size far outweighs mine. His damage potential exceeds any loose brick or dilapidated chair I could throw at him. If he attacks, we're finished. Both of us. It doesn't matter if I stand in front of Zamora, because he will roll over me as if a charging cavalry and leave me broken, bruised, and bleeding out on this hard floor, then do likewise to Zamora. Then slowly, as if an unsaid prayer is being answered, the beast turns his eyes from facing us inside the mill to glancing outside toward the jungle. He tilts his head, points an Aya toward the door. Is he hearing something? But despite being concerned with the trees, he brings his muddy eyes back on us, still lusting for our blood. The sound comes louder, the sounds the gorilla heard, the ka-thump stomping of something approaching. It draws the gorilla to turn and look back. Jago gallops from the dark woodlands, his mane whirling in flight and his hooves thumping the earth. He rears up at the doorway beside the gorilla, paddling his hooves in a gallant threat, and then lands with a stomp, exploding onto the earth in a splash of mud. Jago steadies his stance into one of power, front legs parted. He lowers his head toward the beast and exhales a profound snort, shooting mist from his nostrils in a spiraling twirl, ready to charge the monster without a flinch, prepared to die. A horse. Zamora says. Relief floods me at the sight of Jago's huge shoulders, powerful legs and strong hooves prepared to defend us. Then quickly comes more fright. What's going to happen? Jago is incredibly powerful, for sure. But he is a horse. He doesn't have claws. He has big teeth, but doesn't possess spiked daggers like the gorilla. He cannot battle that beast. He needs my help, I whisper to Zamora, her hugging into my side. The gorilla and Jago block the doorway in a standoff. The bulging arms of the gorilla twitching, eager to wrap them around Jago's neck in a stranglehold. He could perhaps throttle Jago's neck and knock him out. But there is something Jago possesses that could send the gorilla to dreamland. The napvines await in the saddlebag. I never caught the other gorilla with the traps, and this is even more difficult and crucial and less likely to succeed. Still, I have to try. But a sudden grab for the vines could spark the gorilla into violence. I maintain my feet firm on the bricks. Wait, not yet. Jago scuffs a hoof through the grassy mire, and the gorilla now forgets about us and faces Jago in a full-on chest expanding affront. He grunts deeply. There's a dreadful moment as they lock eyes. The powerful look in the gorilla's eyes, eyes beating that show no weakness, stifles my hope that he will turn from Jago and go away, leaving us. The gorilla snorts again, a louder buff, and then he does turn, but he turns toward Zamora and myself. He's going to end us. The next few seconds could be the most important but last of my life. As that gorilla will soon rip its giant teeth into my neck and fling me across the mill. But hopefully, with enough time for Zamora to escape on Jago's back. When he grabs me, I whisper to Zamora. Get on Jago and ride. No, she whispers. Yes. The gorilla paws forward. But before entering the mill's doorway, Jago explodes from his position and rams his strong head into the gorilla's chest. He catches him off balance and sends him tumbling and sliding along the mud. The sight of that beast being put down is remarkable, impossible. But unfortunately, he stays upon the muddy grasses for less than a moment. The gorilla rolls from off his hairy back and recovers, steadying on all fours. He opens his mouth and displays his teeth and in one lethal swoop, bounds onto Jago. Jago rebounds and bucks spinning in the air in great leaps as if a wild Brumby being broken in, while the gorilla claws onto his front shoulders, biting him, hanging on with all the muscles in his body. I've got the dagger. Zamora calls, and I turn to see the blade in her hands. She steps forward without regard or thought that her small body will be trampled by those brutes. No, you don't, I say, and whip it from her hands and dash outside. Despite possessing the blade, it is not the weapon that can stop this beast. Desperate for the vines, I charge to the saddlebag while Jago and the gorilla tussle in a cacophony of stomping hooves, grunts, and snorts. Getting right beside them, Carefully with ducks of my head and sidesteps, avoiding flailing hooves and gorilla legs, I reach for the bag. The gorilla smashes me across my chest with one swipe of his hand. The wind is blown from my lungs in a single gust, and I tumble onto the earth with a back-bruising thud and drop the dagger. "You reckless addlehead!" Zamora calls and rushes to my side. Jago takes advantage of the gorilla's distraction of whacking me and bites the monster's arm, and with the full weight of his body and a powerful fling of his neck, he tosses the gorilla, the whole huge thing full of muscle and teeth, and the beast's body careens through the air and spanks into the sturdy trunk of a nearby tree. The sound of his crunching bones into the hard timber is shocking, but at least it's not the sound of his teeth crunching into my bones or chomping on my throat. Zamora helps me to my feet as Jago backs up toward us while we all keep our concern on the gorilla. The brute shakes his head from the impact as he lies in reedy patches of wet and wild grass, not knocked out, not finished. And after a quick stretch of his back to release any chinks, the gorilla gets up. Once again he offers a terrifying stance toward Jago, braced upon all fours, growling deeply. That hit into the tree was enough to knock out a bull. There is no way we can beat him without the vines. "Creepers," Zamora says, confused. "Special ones." Jago, defiant, sinks his hooves into the grass and lowers his head toward the gorilla again, the stirrups clinking by the saddle. The gorilla seems largely unharmed, but Jago's throwing the gorilla might have just allowed time to grab the vines. Jago pounds a hoof onto the earth and prepares to charge him, but I call, "Wait, Jago." The gorilla's head turns to me in a questioning gaze, understanding my call contains some lethal tactic. "Careful," Zamora says as she collects my dagger. Holding out my hand to calm her, to let her know there is a plan behind this madness, I creep toward the saddlebag, doing my utmost not to startle the gorilla into a charge. My every step upon the wet grass, the ape examines with his earthy brown eyes, ringed by the black around the iris. "Do not come for me." He puffs a threatening waft of air. Even his breath sounds dominant. I reach the saddlebag without him moving little more than his king-size head, the brute always watching. However, when I slip my hand into the leather bag and grab the vine by the root bulb and slide it out, the gorilla stiffens its muscles in recognition. The ridge above his eyes lowers. He bounds into a charge. My first flash thought is to run in a mad dash toward the woods to draw him away from Zamora, perhaps wrap this vine around my own arm and knock myself unconscious to numb the sensation of him beating my skull into a puddle of porridge. But instead, I take a firm grip of the root bulb and the swinging vine and take off running toward the gorilla. This is madness. The gorilla's giant body bounds forward in a four-pawed run, its fur a haze of copper-trimmed blackness, his pounding momentum thumping the earth. His face brandishes a manic snarl. Whether he bites me or boulders right through me, either one will leave me dead. Zamora calls, "Kid," in an attempt to reach my senses and cause me to flee, but I hold out the vines, the bulb feeling like a tough potato with a rope of poisoning pricks. For the moment, I consider squeezing my eyes shut so my last vision is not this beast sinking its jaws into my neck, but I shut that from my mind and keep running toward his body. With the monster a heartbeat away, a huge frame that blacks out the dark night, I swing the vines with a whip of my arm. Instantly, the gorilla's whopping hand slams across my face, the heavy impact of a jawbone-jarring collision as if whacked by a tree trunk. The force sends me flying back into the soaked surface where I crash and roll along the grass and land in a mound of mud and curl into a pile of bruised mess. All the breath rushes out of me as the beast howls. With my sapped strength, I raise my head, feeling like my jaw is crushed, and see the vine that Madame Slibernie engineered wrapped around one of the gorilla's legs. He pulls back his lips in a crazed scowl and grunts like a cow being scolded. The vines quickly cling onto his bulk and fur and muscles and dig right in, digging, piercing. Zamora rushes to my side. "Is anything broken?" I feel my jawline. Only tenderized. Again the ape grunts and then stops moving. Standing still on the grassy clearing no more than 5 yards from Jago watching him with quiet concern. The gorilla turns his leg in another angle and tries to remove the vine, gripping it with his leathery hands, but in the course of grabbing it, he jabs his fingers and palms and sends more poison through his bloodstream. He drops the vine in frustration and turns on all fours and regards me with flaring eyes, knowing it's the young man in the mud who's caused him this pain. "WRRRH," he says with lips wobbling. That could be gorilla tongue for "my fists will beat your face," or "I'm feeling sleepy." Either way, he struggles toward me with an expression of revenge scrawled across in wrinkles in his forehead, his groggy head rocking side to side like he's slowly dancing to sweet music. He closes in, Zamora holding me while I sit dazed. Zamora tries to pull me back. Closer he comes, the scent of his breath takes the thin gap of the air between us. Then he collapses to the ground, with just his forearms raising his upper body. "Gray," he goes and reaches forward and touches my boot. Jago comes, as the gorilla's head plumps to the soil to where he rolls onto his back. His wide chest rises and falls. The muddy eyes close, the beast knocked out asleep as the sleeping beauty in Perot's tale. Zamora hooks a hand under my arm and helps me get up off the ground, relief flowing through me as steady as the napping gorilla's breathing. "Those vines will keep him asleep all night," I say to Zamora. "He tracked us by the smell of my sleeve." Zamora places her hands on my shoulders in such a tender way that soothes the bruises in my body. "Cheval would have sent him to hunt us." Zamora's voice sounds as comforting as her touch, and maybe after battling a gorilla, she's coming to understand me, drawing to me. And standing under the belt of stars starting to show through the breaking clouds, the girl is probably hopeful for a kiss. I touch her hands that are on my shoulders, ready to pull her in close and sneak that kiss. Gently, I grip her fingers. "Yes, now's the time." Jago snorts. Zamora's eyes spring to the horse. "Why?" "It was a stupid huff." "And who is our rescuer?" Zamora says, and pushes me aside with a shove to my chest and skips to Jago. "Damn Frisian." "That's Jago," I say, eyeing him a little angrily for thieving my moment. "Be careful, Zamora, he's..." Zamora cloaks her arms around his shoulders and buries her head into Jago's neck like they've been best friends for years. "Dangerous," I mumble, finishing my sentence. "Your mane is so profuse, Jago." Zamora ruffs his scraggy fringe, gazing at it like it is a tailored dress. "It's gorgeous." How can she love his messy hair but pay no heed to mine? Jago neighs a high-pitched whinny and hugs his head around her like they are best friends. Well, they're not. Zamora scratches his back, selfishly trying to pilfer all his affections. Where did the beautiful horse come from? "He's David's Frisian, and David taught me how to ride." I scrub Jago's dry, warm belly. "He must have been sheltering in the jungle. And he loves me the most. He came running for my whistle, after all." "Your whistle," Zamora says, implying her loud, crisp whistle was the one he heard and not my muffled slobber. Then Zamora rubs her hands all over his neck and I his chin. Zamora gives Jago a kiss on the forehead, which he acceptingly lowers his head for. "This is preposterous." I barge in front of Zamora and spread out my arms. "He's had enough," I say. Perhaps a little out of jealousy, and perchance he's just had enough scratching. Sometimes we all have too much scratching. Zamora forgets our battling for Jago's affections and slinks under his neck, to his other side. "The gorilla bite is bleeding," she says. "It looks deep and fleshy and needs stitching." Bleeding. Flashy. Stitching. Fleshy, not flashy. She glances at me from around the horse's shoulder. "Loon." I cover my ears. "Stop saying fleshy." Zamora slides back under Jago's neck, and I turn around because the girl has this expression dancing over her face that suggests she wants me to lay eyes on the disgusting wound. There's an old first aid. She grabs me and spins me around. "Face the horse, kid." Then she pulls my hands down from my face. "Stop covering your eyes." Some mud flicked in them, and I was wiping it out. That lie doesn't even convince myself. "Grab the first aid kit that contained the cloth," Zamora says. "It's in the drawer." The kit contained a needle. "Grab the cloth too. Not sure about thread though." "I can pull a thread from a wheat sack." Zamora wiggles her lips, contemplating my answer. "Clever. Maybe I am a natural surgeon." After retrieving the thread and first aid kit, I hand them to Zamora, then clench my eyes shut and dab Jago's wound with the cloth. Zamora then begins stitching, making quiet breathing sounds of concentration. Jago grunts, perhaps a grunt of agony. The procedure sounds interesting, so I hold my chin and lean in close and watch Zamora do her work and learn with intrigue, perhaps like Dad, a scientist, observing the operation of Zamora re-sewing Jago's reddish-pink torn flesh. Reddish-pink torn and nauseating flesh. The world suddenly begins twirling while I'm flying upside down. Kid. Zamora grabs me. You're turning whiter than a mushroom. While she inspects my eyes, her pupils move back and forth like a pendulum in a grandfather clock. You're going to pass out. Doesn't take a genius to know that. Stand on the other side of Jago where you can't see anything and rub his forehead. It will relax him. She gawks at me. It will relax you both. Away from the operation, I rub Jago's forehead as Zamora stitches away, the needle slithering through skin, through flesh, and out of the cold night Zamora says, oops, and Jago replies a squealing whinny of Nier and thumps his head into me, knocking me into the wet grass, and I point up at him and tell the fool, she jabbed you, and glare at him. He glares back with a big bold eye, then curls his head into Zamora. Clapping bells, he's stupid. Zamora finishes her needlework, then I retrieve my dagger and conceal it back in my boot while she recovers the compass from the barn. We draw together, realizing we are about to venture into the woods. Do you think Aletta has returned and is out there looking for us? Zamora says. Or maybe the others. It's uncertain as the seas, I say, feeling that a better answer would comfort Zamora, and so I search for one. But with the dark jungle looming and possibly hiding someone in its shadows, all I can squeeze out is the same, uncertain as the seas. Chapter 19. Jago nips and nibbles at the bridle as I try to hook him up, and then he rips it from my hands and flings the pile of leather straps away, and they go jangling into the mud. You're making me look amateurish, I tell him, and try again. There's grunting and biting from both of us, but after almost scrapping off his left ear with the leather strap, I jostle the bridle on. Then with a boot dug into a stirrup, I swing up and on his back. Jago's body warms my legs as he dances his hooves like a Spanish Andalusian dancing horse, circling Zamora. I tug his reins to make him stop showing off, but it doesn't work. This horse is more stupid than me. Ignoring the antics of Jago, I stretch out my hand for Zamora. She ignores my hand and takes hold of the back of the saddle, jumps up and squeezes in behind. The saddle could be a little bigger, Zamora says, squirming for room. It's not such a bad feeling, having her body pressed against my back. The saddle could be a little smaller though, and with a grin, I say, lean in and wrap your arms around me. Zamora exhales a little frustration and slowly puts her warm hands on the sides of my waist. All the way around, I tell her and flex my abs, and she mumbles as her arms reluctantly slide around my Michelangelo carved marble abdominals, pretending she's not impressed. The insolent girl tickles my lower side, where it's flabby and soft. There's a tiny bit of Florida. Shush, I say, and give Jago a gentle nudge in his flab, which in actuality is all muscle, and get us moving. But before Jago takes 10 paces, the female gorilla emanates from the edge of the jungle. She leaves the cover of the trees and slowly paces out in the grassy clearing, the baby clinging to her back. It's the gorilla that spied on us earlier, and the same one Madame Slibberny never caught. She heads to the male lying on his back. She must have heard him roaring, I whisper, as the female gorilla stands over the male and regards us, detecting whether we are a threat. But she decides we are not and forgets us. The baby gorilla crawls off her back and snuggles onto the father's shoulders. The female inspects the vines around his leg, then carefully placing her hands so as not to be pricked, begins entangling it from him, one little jabby prick at a time. Then, with the vine lying in the grass, she just sits with him, waiting for him to awaken. At least someone's happy now, Zamora says. And we leave them be and enter the jungle where the shadows of its thick verdure settles over us. A path where the trees are slightly less copious allows glimpses of Sirius and guides us toward Porto Ota, and we ride on through the thick of wind-blown trees, deeper into the trackless forest. Low-hanging branches lashing out through the cover of darkness force us to duck and weave. There is no time for stalling, for gathering our composure, so we do nothing other than ride in a tentative, quiet walk, with eyes peeled toward every shadow, and ears, listening to every clink of a stick or rustle of branches outstretched. After a few miles in, Jago's ears start twitching as if the inner ear is crawling with ants, but something tells me it's not six-legged insects. "What's out there, Jago?" He doesn't answer. Guess he can't talk. Cicadas produce a rhythmic, droning shrill that seems to echo off every tree and stone. A gentle rustle of the leaves blows tenderly above, but that's all that appears to be present. It's probably red deer frolicking in the woods. Jago suddenly snorts and flitters like a jumpy racehorse. "What is it, boy?" Again, nothing peculiar is visible in the shadows. "Keep moving, Jago, or we might get caught." Jago's body sideways walks like he doesn't wish to go where he's led, but with some extra prodding I manage to straighten him and he slowly moves on. "Caught." Zamora grips my flab. "I mean ab." "We won't get caught," I say, patting her knee, patting it to calm her and for the sneaky chance just to touch her nice knee. "They think we drown."
"I hope."
"Drowned," she says.
"You told me drowned before."
"Depends on the tense." Jago furnishes a loud nyai and stomps to a halt, making me tense. Leaves rustle in the woods, but not the sound of leaves from above in the winds, it's coming from the ground. Ahead in the wilderness, something is moving through the brushes and trunks, watching us. With only Jago and our thoughts as allies, it's likely Zamora and I are wondering the same thing: is it men hunting us with swords and guns? Suddenly, the thunderous sound of galloping horses wheels around us in the jungle, as if we're caught in the middle of a tornado of hooves, menacing us from every angle and every tree. Jago rears up, and it's so high on his back I struggle to hang on, Zamora clinging to me. Devere and Balin each appear on the blackish-gray Percheron horses, flanking us. To search for a way out, I turn Jago in a tight circle and trace my sight around the woods, but it feels like we're enclosed by the bars of a prison cell. A huge fallen oak blocks the only path. "They tracked us until they found a way to corner us," I say quietly. Guff emerges from the trees to our right, tunnel sludge evident on his corded and tasseled fur as he creeps behind us and blocks any chance of retreat. Zamora claws my stomach, whispering, "There's no river to jump into this time." Oh, for a river and a boat to row away in, but we are stuck deep in this forest and must face our foes. Devere leans forward, his saddle creaking. "You hand us that compass now, boy." "We lost it in the river," I say. "Either way," he says, "you know about it now, so." Devere, Balin, and Guff border us not a half-tree length away, eyes set on our throats, blood boiling with desires of murder. They leave their stationary position and edge toward us and narrow the circle like a pack of wolves stalking an injured deer. I guess one of them is half-wolf. Amidst the tension, David's words whisper in my ear, "Use the landscape to your advantage." The dark, thick jungle surrounds us with many trees that would cover our tracks. If we could get a start on them, we could disappear. Jago is fast and agile, they won't catch him. But how do we make our break? The only path, the fallen oak lying between Devere and Balin. I grip the reins somewhat tenser than the standard, firm yet soft. "Squeeze my flab a little tighter," I tell Zamora. The air is sweet and crisp, and I gather a lungful which will be needed in the chase, then sit straight and direct Jago toward the tree in slow, careful steps. He huffs as if understanding my command without a word, and without needing to sink my heels into his ribs, Jago explodes. The great animal launches over the tree, the world caught in strange slow motion. Devere and Balin convene atop their horses, ready to ride like cowboys, but they sit staring at us, shocked as we soar through the air, as if they're one of the trees rooted to the earth. The mighty oak passes beneath us as if a hapless twig, and I catch a glimpse of Jago's eye, fearless. A landing thump brings back the moment, and everything wheels into motion. Zamora grips her arms forcefully around my waist as if a clawing napvine, and Devere and Balin kick their steeds and gallop off after us in a pounding fury of hooves. Split seconds turn to moments, moments flare into flashes as we dodge trunks, duck branches, dip into ditches, and dive through the dazzling maze of oaks, pines, and chestnuts scattered and clustered. No time to calculate a route, no time to make decisions, just flying on instinct, pure gut. Branches and vines whisk past as Jago gallops hard, his hooves a thunder worthy of the passing storm.
He drives us deeper into the jungle, where whatever subtle glow the moon and stars offered is suffocated to nil. The woodland grows blacker, denser. Trees and massive outstretched branches, as if holding hands with other trees of the forest, flash in shadow, and if not for Jago's agility, I'd ride into them and knock our heads silly. I flit my eyes heavenward for a glance of Sirius, to pray for its guidance, but it's hopeless, for darkness envelopes the forest. Never a chance. It's impossible for my eyes to spot a speck of light in a storm of interlaced leaves so tightly wound, where all we can do is feel our way recklessly through the jungle on the back of a horse that is grunting, gasping, galloping with legs outstretched. We gallop on, gallop hard and far. After passing through masses of trees and shrubs and vines that almost snag our necks and hang us upright in the woods alone, without warning, Jago spooks and slams to a stop. I slide over his head, once again try to grab an ear but fail in my reach, and then fall to the ground with a backside bruising whump. Zamora has been thrown forward and hangs over Jago's neck like a monkey who's tumbled in a tree, although she did manage to cling on. She settles back on the saddle, flips her hair over her face and says, "You eating some grass like a horse?" I tug out some grass from the earth. Apparently, it's quite nutritious. Decent riding, though. Her compliment almost makes me blush. And although sitting flat out on the ground like a cowboy tossed from a brumby, it is not so embarrassing. Because we rode so far and fast that there is no chance those thugs could follow us on their mares. No one could keep up to what we just did, so there is a reasonable amount of relief to keep any embarrassing red forming on my cheeks. I get up while dusting my pants, left pant cheek damp with a nutritious grass stain. But more important than nutrition is the huge jagged wall of rock confronting us, at least hundreds of feet high, the one I spotted from the hill. Our getaway path ends here. All around us the impenetrable wall of stone blocks our route ahead, and the trees only thicken either side. I look around frantically for some other way, a barely undetectable secret passage in the rock, maybe a tunnel dug beneath, but there is nothing, and no way forward but to the stars, and no way up to those stars other than via Cheval's hot air balloon, and he isn't going to be dropping by in that. No, we are blocked by this giant cliff. I approach the massive earth, lays my hands upon it, and press my face against the side of the cold mountain and stare up. Its crest runs upward in jagged rifts and disappears into the night, the hunk of rock and stone cold like the moisture that now smears my pants. "There's no way around the cliff," I say to Zamora. "And there are no stars to follow, only blackness. We can hide here a while, but they'll find us eventually." Zamora doesn't say anything, but I can sense her thinking through the back of my head. Not her thinking through my head senses her thoughts, out the back because I am facing the wall of rock. I stop trying to think her thoughts, confusing my mind more so, and turn around and look her square in the eyes and concentrate on deciding our next move. I remount Jago and peer back into the jungle, toward the direction where the stars can be seen. It's the only way. "We have to venture back into the woods," I say. "With forests this profuse, it's possible we could slip by them. But if not, if we can't stay undetected, we may have to face them, possibly fight them. If not for the nerves flooding my system, the thought of doing hand combat with Devere may have frozen me as solid as the giant rock." "Shouldn't we keep running?" Zamora says. "Run where?" I say. "The woods only continue. And this mountain of rock is huge, I've seen it in daylight. If we follow it along, it eventually falls into a cliff by a waterfall where they'll corner us. We can fight. We can use the night, the illusion of the dark." Zamora looks deeply into the jungle, as if foreseeing the battle. She takes a moment and then nods. "The dark's always been good to me. The dark always kept me afraid as a child, guess now it might hide us from our fears, from men wanting us dead." I glide my hand along Jago's neck where every fiber of his muscles fills me with a touch of confidence, yet with a coldness, from the danger, as if a touch of frost on the edges of a winter window. We have the advantage, we have Jago. But my legs still feel weak, and I attempt to bring a strength from somewhere deep inside me, something Dad has always tried to instill. I remember when he tried to encourage me to hop back on our old mare a few weeks after she trampled me. The contusions remained on my arm, and my arms appeared all black and blue and purple, and all I could manage was tears and to tell Dad, "No, no. But he wasn't upset with me. He roughed my hair and said, "You'll ride again, Link. That strength is growing." Although that strength is not sitting with me all that securely, much like a slippery boot in a loose stirrup, I have let go of those trampling bruises and am now sitting upon a saddle, holding onto Jago's reins, riding again, and not only riding, riding to meet the battle. I direct Jago the way we came and return to the woods. The profuse supply of trees surrounds us like a spiderweb as we move, though not moving at a gallop, but with gentle steps of a heavy Frisian who somehow keeps his steps light as we peer into the shadows for our pursuers. The jungle lightens into a lighter shade of dark, revealing flickers of starlight, and after intense moments of drifting through the murky woods, Zamora squeezes a little too tightly into my stomach. "A shadow moved in the distance," Zamora whispers. Shadows prowl in every corner of the forest, the night enveloping us along with the darkness. "That girl is just so frightened, as am I, that she is imagining things." Zamora gently places her thumb and forefinger to my chin and turns my gaze forward. "Beyond the trees," she whispers. "Someone is coming." I peer through the black jungle and shadows. "Keep looking," she says. It feels as though Zamora is not making sense, but her voice is so certain and not rattled and frenzied with fear that she must have spotted something. Obscurities are everywhere, the flickering of the subtlest of light, and so I bring us to a halt and we look and listen. The woods are bursting with many sounds, even more so at night, but when being hunted by two men and a half wolf wanting your blood, the noises are endless. Suddenly comes the sound of something a little suspicious, the creaking and cracking of sticks that lay on the ground, and not long after, hooves. Slowly, stepping through the jungle at a pace no faster than ours, a set of hooves trample on sticks and shrubs. The horse is somewhere approaching, but even though I peer into the stand of trees, nothing is seen or spotted. Whatever or whomever is lurking out there, the thick of trees conceal it from me. Then yet again, the sound of hooves breaking sticks. I keep blinking, struggling for focus until a distinct shadow emerges. At first, it's just a shimmer against the wind-swirling trees, a wobbly blotch of black in the jungle, like a small bush waving in a stiff wind. An object, barely evident. The shadow shifts. Moving. A nightmarish figure creeping forward. The steadiness of my belly tapers and twists, and I focus on the single blotch of moving shadow, and then, in a way so freakish and frightening, like waking from a deep sleep to find everything all a haze, until the images form in clarity, the blotch slowly begins to clear, merging from a lump of scraggy cloud into a single line of shadow. The figure, the moving shadow, is faltering perhaps 50 yards ahead to our right amidst the jungle. The shadows and blurs continue to gather and blend into a solid dark frame, and the image merges into a physique of a large man on a horse, with its tail flipping in the breeze, man and animal slipping between the trees. Balin bumps on his horse, ducking the branches, coming toward us. I tap Samora's hand, acknowledging. We stay still. Silent. Maybe we can sneak past him, sneak by all who loiter in the jungle, and head back to Porto Oda. I gently move Jago to the left, trying to circle wide of Balin to avoid any conflict, sticks crimping beneath Jago's hooves. Part of me wants to scream at the sticks stop snapping and breaking, but they are only twigs and the best thing they know how to do is snap. While Balin rides unfazed like he is in a dream world, mumbling and arguing with himself, we keep moving away from the large man, inching closer and closer to a path where he will never see us, a pathway unseen. A bigger stick snaps beneath the weight of Jago. Balin instantly shuts his blabbering lips and falls so silent the wind can be heard whispering a chill of a warning. "Run," it whispers. "Run." Balin peers through the night, through the stand of branching trees, making us pause, unmoving as the trunks of the oaks and pines in the shadows. There's an erratic urge to follow the wind's whispers, to kick Jago in the flanks again and gallop, but my heels stay low in the stirrups and my legs remain by his side. "Ride away, Balin." Balin mumbles some more but doesn't listen to the voices in my head and turns his percheron our direction, the blackish-gray steed catching glimmers of light as it begins creeping forward. He heard that stick crunch beneath Jago's hoof. That big brute heard it for sure and is coming to investigate. He moves closer, then his eyes stop rebounding around the jungle and stare. A gaze so set and still that it is beyond doubt that he is eyeing something very specific in the forest. Balin's whole hefty body draws tense, taut. Crouching close against the neck of his horse, he rolls his neck and gathers the reins in one hand. Although it's only one man, it feels like being attacked by a cavalry. His horse senses his motives and snorts, a gut-wrenching battle cry of a horse that is used to melees. A snort so fearless that it travels through the woods and sweeps through my body and grips my heart like a fist. The possible following moments transpire like living pictures in my head. This disgusting bearded brute will clatter me off Jago with one blow of his sword. I'll be jerking in foaming convulsions on the ground while my blood spills out from my body and stains the earth as he takes Zamora back to Cheval or stabs her belly. Again, Zamora clenches her hands into my stomach. It imparts in me such a heavy feeling knowing our fate depends on these next few seconds. Although clashing in a duel like this is not desired, it is perhaps the very worst thing to take a life, but it is him or us. Zamora's steady breath confirms she has reached her limits of cowering. My cowering is already broken. I try tense the reins firm yet soft, ready to fight, ready for our possible last breaths. But last breaths that we will be breathing together, and if Balin is going to try and take our lives, with God watching, we'll be fighting for our living breath all the way. I turn Jago toward Balin and whisper in his ear, "Be nimble. Be ready." Balin, keeping one hand steady with the reins, draws a sword. It shimmers cold in the shadows, streaks of steel gleaming. A call of death. He shifts station on his horse, wiggling his cumbersome backside into a position of comfort, then kicks his percheron in the flanks. It's too late to turn back, his horse galloping onward from tree to tree, unafraid. "Now's the time to use the illusion of the dark," I whisper. I heel Jago, and he hurtles into a gallop. We ride and weave through the jungle, closing in on Balin. It is near unbelievable to be riding toward a man wielding a sword in anger, but I charge relentlessly with a feeling inside that has heard the sound of the bugle, the battle cry, and is unable to turn back. The jungle flashes by, and I veer Jago toward a solid oak. Balin storms forward, nearly closing the distance between us to little more than a lasso length. He gallops with abandon, mouth drawn into a grimace and sword raised as if to collect us in one blow. The oak is just beyond reach when Balin looks right in my eyes. I eye off a low-hanging branch from the oak. He advances his arm, holding his sword like a woodcutter about to swing a blow. I shout over my shoulder, "Duck, Zamora!" Our horses are about to collide, Balin ready to swing steel. Jago sidesteps the onrushing horse with a tricky dash of his legs. We duck. Balin doesn't. Balin's head thumps into the branch with an almighty wallop, slamming so hard it sweeps him off his horse in one foul swoop. The impact is hard and solid, a frightening crack that would scatter 100 crows. I glance over my shoulder as Balin thuds into the earth like a dropped pumpkin, a brief tumble where his hands grasp lifelessly at shrubs. He lies face down, arms and legs spread out from beneath the weight of his vast frame. His body shivers, then falls limp. I shift my weight in the saddle and ease back on the reins, and Jago prances his hooves and dances left to right, still struggling to heed my faltering stopping instructions. But a little persistence soon brings Jago's gallant legs to a halt on the earth. Gasping breath floats from all three of our mouths in a silver mist. My stomach churns like grifts of floating seaweed in a storm, because it's confusing whether killing the man was the right thing. Driving him head-on into that branch. But he was after us, after Zamora, and he wouldn't have stopped, and then I realize. "Devere's still out there," I say, peering through the mist of my breath. "You think that move will work on him?" Zamora's voice is soft and shocked. Devere's brown, glassy eyes come to mind, the way they look at me, look through me, how he doesn't overtalk but is thinking, always discerning. And that brings the only true answer, no. Devere cannot be trounced with any of my tricks. If he finds us. I block the thought of Devere catching us, and once more look back. Balin remains lying face down like a fallen tree. He appears not to be breathing, and surely wouldn't be, but the man should be checked just in case, it's the right thing to do. Hell, maybe it isn't. I don't know. Maybe we should just gallop out of here, before others come. But we have to see if he needs. I don't know. Something. I slide off Jago. We have to check Balin. Zamora accompanies me, in a steady walk. Balin's Percheron stands startled behind a tree, snorting heavily, scuffing the ground. Balin's face is shrouded in grasses, and I kneel beside him and press my fingers on his red hairy neck. There's no pulse. Then beside his face, beside his nose that is pressed to the grass, and where a single eye stares straight at the dirt, blood is appearing, and it is terribly black in the dead of night, fanning around the man's skull in a horrifying, sickening puddle. I look away and squeeze my eyes shut for a moment, tensing all the muscle fibers in my stomach to prevent myself from vomiting. With some time to settle, I look up to Zamora and shake my head. Her eyes respond without blinking, knowing we have killed the man. This is my fault. A man's life ends because of my decisions. But there was no alternative. A need to sleep heavily, and for a long time overcomes my body, the need to fall in a dreamland and forget the frightful outcome of my actions. But reckless emotion must not lead me now, not now. Our lives, mine and Zamora's, still need protecting. The Percheron kicks out from behind the tree and circles us, jumping and snorting. Maybe he is angry over the death of his rider, or perhaps just frightened himself, but he offers an idea. My attempts to steady the steed only see him rear up and kick. If Devere finds us, we split up, I say, spreading my arms to calm the Percheron. People do that to calm horses, but it's doubtful that it works. You take Jago and I'll ride this horse, and Devere will chase me. Let's just go, Zamora says, gripping my arm and tugging me toward Jago. He won't find us. Zamora stands firm in the dark of the jungle, a strong-willed girl who wouldn't leave me, but she must if it comes to it. I grip her shoulders and speak with intensity. If he does, we split up. He'll pursue me. And you keep following those stars. Ride fast and ride far and don't look back. Zamora shakes her head. I'm not asking, I tell her. That's our plan. I release Zamora's shoulders and turn back to Balin's horse. Let's calm this pony. Zamora stands for a moment and breathes out a long exhalation, confirming although she has doubts, she is siding with me on the plan, at least for now. She approaches Balin's horse, and the Percheron snorts and backs away. Jago comes to our aid and moves near the frightened steed, and I take cover beside Jago's shoulder until close enough to take the Percheron's reins. Upon slipping out from beside Jago and securing the leather straps, I manage to ease the horse, but he bucks violently with lashing hooves when I attempt to get up on his back. There's a curl of rope hooked on the saddle, which I grab and use to tie his reins to Jago's saddle horn. The Percheron backs away and makes trouble for Jago, but Jago holds him firmly, stepping the opposite direction. The Percheron blows heavy puffs, snorts, and then finally begins to lower his frantic breathing and begins to settle. Jago will calm him, I say to Zamora. Give him a minute. Then we'll leave. That minute is going to pass like an hour. Balin's sword catches my attention as it lies by a tree, nearly concealed by blades of grass. It could protect us, defend us against a possible attack, but it's unlikely I've the stomach to use it anyway. Regardless, I step tentatively toward it, heart beating erratically. The pressure of picking up the weapon overwhelms me into closing my eyes in an attempt to control my trepidation. When calm and thinking clearly, I hear water running in the distance. I open my eyes to the direction of the water, and through the dark resides a small silvery cliff face and the Viperae flowing beneath it. The river moves effortlessly in the blackness, like a long black snake, sliding, the stars reflecting off the water. Crickle, comes a sound from the woods. Although it can't be seen, something is creeping in the dark. The sword is a mere stride and reach away, but before I can grab it, a vicious growl ignites the night. Guff hurtles from the gloom, slams into my chest and has me flattened upon the grasses. Balin's horse neighs so loudly it's frightening all in itself, and a glance over shows the horse bucking and tangling Jago with their rope to a tree. Kid! Zamora calls again, in that too familiar tone of dread. Guff stands atop of me, his claws scratch my chest causing white-hot pain, and I punch his mouth, causing his tooth to pierce my knuckle. He shakes his head like my punch felt like little more than a fly swat, then he thrusts for my throat. My hands react and catch his corded and matted neck and hold him back. The hound opens his jaws, and then with a thrash he bites out with a snap-snap inches over my lips, his hot breath smothering and thick, as flecks of slobber drip on my face. If those jaws clamp hold of me, they will never be unlocked. Zamora wraps her arms around the dog's chest and somehow wrenches him away. In the tussle, Guff turns on her and claws into her neck, leaving three viscous streaks of red. "Do not touch her." Before he can sink those teeth into Zamora, I rise and bound upon his back, snatching him in a headlock. Guff snarls and tries to kick out from my hold, then grah, he barks in a snarling huff, a bone-chilling sound. I take my dagger with my other hand and hold it out. Can I really do this? Stab a dog. Before there is time to swing a blow, Guff lays his eyes upon the blade and jerks his body with a mighty thrust and sinks his teeth into my arm. Pain shoots through my forearm as if stabbed by a dozen steak knives, and it causes me to drop the blade. Guff scraps loose out of my hold and steadies upon the earth, and with a single whirlwind whip of his body and tail, he turns his muddy face in my direction. The horses are braying, but Jago is secured and cannot help. I scramble away from the wolf-like dog, and Zamora sticks her hand in my belt and pulls me upright. "Stay on your feet," she says, her voice a nerve of concentration. Guff stands before us with a mist of heat rising from his shoulder blades, like the silver glistening of the moon. But the hound is not a sight for admiring. He hunches his head, hair corded, gray-black and greasy, with the remainder of the sewer dripping from his fur in dangling drips. His eyes slim as his powerful legs bend into a spring, waiting to uncoil. In the scrimmage with Guff, we've moved from the sword, and my dagger is hidden somewhere in the grass. I could punch the dog, kick him, but it would barely make him flinch, and he doesn't seem like a dog who would run away to fetch any sticks. And so I whisper to Zamora, "When he takes me, you run to Jago." The girl, despite trembling, clenches a fist. "He'll have to take us both." So much to learn from this Ipianian. Guff, as if understanding we intend to fight, breathes raggedly through his nose, creating an angry, snotty snort. His lips raise as if tasting our skin, considering how fast he should devour us. And then Guff rears up and leaps forward, claws and rows of teeth soaring through the air. A flash whips from the shadows and something pelts into Guff's side, and he hits the ground and yelps as he rolls in a tangle of fur. Another dog. My eyes adjust quickly, revealing Paluto. The two dogs spool on the grasses and shrubs, and it's so fast and hectic it's near impossible to tell which one is which, a mere mixed ball of grayish-black and rustic bronze. They somewhat steady, and Paluto bites hard into Guff's neck and they continue to roll, then break apart both gathering their feet. "Paluto!" I call. But there is no time for reunions, as Guff leaves Paluto and returns for me. Paluto, not to be outdone, bounds into him once more in a heavy clash, caught once more in a wrangle of fur, fangs, and claws. The sounds of the dog's snarling eats up the night. They reel apart again, then stand and face each other no more than a leap away, growling and circling, their paws swishing a gentle horror through the blades of green. Briards have always tried to bite into my ankles, but now there is one trying to save me. Never thought that is a sight I'd witness. Guff launches himself toward Paluto, howling like a savage wolf. Paluto reveals his own teeth and rears up, his legs springing him forward. They collide, but Guff is too formidable and claws Paluto's face and sinks his teeth into his shoulder. As Guff draws back ready to lash at Paluto's throat, I call, "Get off my friend," and hurtle onto the wolf, but with a sturdy fling of his body he pitches me aside. I ready to charge back into the fray, but Zamora grabs my dagger from off the ground, and with the full weight of her body, she steps forward and thrusts the dagger into Guff's throat. It was so swift, so fast. Her eyes wide in shock, she wobbles back on her heels, stumbling. The sound of Guff's wail is frightening and ripples through the leaves, perhaps even chilling the birds. Blood drips from his corded fur in horrid lumps, and the badly wounded animal staggers away with his head and tail low slung. He coughs hard, a hoarse grating bark that oozes with pain, and I feel what he's feeling. He plummets into some long, grassy shrubs. His back legs offer a final spasmodic jerk, then fall stiff beside his tail. Zamora stands motionless with Guff's blood smeared on her hands and cheek. It's a frightful sight to see her standing with another's blood. It shocks me and keeps me silent. She drops the dagger and slowly kneels beside Paluto as he lies on the grass, breathing but bloody and in pain. I fall to my knees beside them both, Zamora gently touching the gold rustic fur of Paluto, and when I wipe the blood from Zamora's cheek with my sleeve, she doesn't flinch, doesn't move my hand away like normal. She is too taken with the shock of what just happened. "Zamora," I say gently. Zamora looks up, eyes big and watery as if they've been filled by a well. She killed Guff, and by the way she's been hugging animals, slaughtering one is the last thing she'd desire. And the memory will be with her always. The pushing the blade into the animal's body, its throat, the way it went in, and even if a savage beast, the memory will never depart someone of such deep feeling. I gaze at her, wanting to say that her actions were just, that her moment of courage saved us, and I part my lips to say something, but no words are found. Zamora massages Paluto's golden floppy ear in her fingertips. "Another of your friends." "A true friend," I say, rubbing his soft shaggy head while his eyes droop at me, like he is asking me to remove the pain in his shoulder. "If only I could, boy." Zamora quickly composes herself and leaves Paluto's ear and examines the cuts on his face and his deep shoulder wound. "He can't walk." Paluto's shoulder blade is torn open, a flash of red and a lip of skin hanging in a loose fold, the bloody sight keeping me from staring too long. But there is also claw marks on Zamora's neck, red and burning. "Your neck." "Another scratch," she says, keeping attention on Paluto. "I'm used to them." Her saying she's used to the pawn reminds me of Dad telling me to get used to the pain of being a fisherman. This girl seems to have a measure of grit. Although her scratches must sting, it's likely the hurt she is feeling in her heart from Paluto's wounds and her killing that wild dog smothers any physical pain like a thick blanket on a fire. The horses are away caught in a tree, and although puffing somewhat are now standing reasonably calmly after our fight. Stupid me. We should have just left straight away on Jago when Zamora wanted to, and maybe Guff would still be alive. But that's in the past, and Madame Slibberny taught me you can't go back and capture it, can't change what is and what's happened. What I must do is accept the present and get up and take us from here. "I'll grab Jago and Balin's Percheron," I say. "Paluto can ride on the saddle too." Approaching the horses, I pass Balin's sword still lying by a tree. The thought of taking it and using it to take another's life burdens me, like a weighty sack of potatoes permanently strapped to my back. But if I took the weapon in the first place, maybe I might have killed Guff. Not that is a heroic thing, but Zamora may not have had to. And that would be oh so good to take back. But that's gone now, and all that is left remaining is the sword. "Pick it up, Lincoln. Bend your knees and pick it up." Leaning down, I wrap my fingers slowly around the hilt until it rests in my palm in a firm grasp. Then I slowly slide the tip of the blade along the grass, drawing it toward me before I hold the blade before my eyes so it could nearly be kissed. The traces of light from the heavens shine a cool glimmer off the steel. The sword is light, but sends a heavy feeling through me. It's the act of taking responsibility and stepping out from the shadow of Dad's protection, which I've hidden under for so long. A deep awareness swells into my body of knowing what this instrument is used for and why the hilt is in my hands. And it's not just that it's used to take life, it is also used to defend it. "If you have the strength." I return to Balin. It is extremely difficult to face the man now departed. A man whose death I arranged. There are no feelings of heroism gushing through me. Not a chance in all this jungle the sword in my hands will be raised in some unmanly triumph. The only thing inside me is a mere empty nothing, a feeling as dead as the man himself. Then with a strange sickness, I untie the scabbard from his belt and fasten it on my belt, a tool passing from one man to another. I slide the sword into the sheath, hoping there will be no need to slide it out. Approaching the horses, it's clear the rope is tangled around a tree. Hate tangles. I'm inspecting the tangle, trying to figure the easiest way to unfurl it, when something moves amongst the woods. "Not more trouble," I whisper. "It can't be." Already exhausted, my head aches to drop, but taking a quick breath, I have my eyes scouring the surrounds. A shadow gallops past, accompanied by the sound of hooves. Emerging from the darkest part of the jungle is Devere, and it's clear he's heading for Zamora. I yell to her with abandon, "Zamora, look out!" Devere leaps off his horse with a kick out from the stirrups and bounds onto her. She falls back hard and hits her head on the earth. From this range, it's too far to hear if her head hit grass or dirt or, God forbid, rock. "Please don't let it be stone." I run so hard toward them, there is no time to take a breath. With a slide of my boots through the grass, I stop in front of her. Zamora lies upon her back in a thick bed of grass, her head tilted toward her shoulder, and her eyes closed as if held captive in deep dreams. No blood is dripping from her head and staining the grass, so although she offers no movement, it appears she is alive. But there remains a threat to her life, De Vere. The brutish man hovers nearby like a rabid vulture. De Vere takes his stance, legs slightly parted for optimum balance. The leather bandana is drawn taut, and underneath protrudes strands of his mottled brown hair, eyes staring in moral corrosion. And then those battle-worn hands reach for the hilt protracting from the scabbard. De Vere withdraws the sword slowly, a muted brushing sound from the leather sheath. The blade and all its sharp edging is brought out into the darkness, the blade that could end my life. My eyes stick to its shine. The crows in these woods, De Vere says in a snickering tone. They'd like to feast on a boy. A ghastly image scars my mind, of myself lying dead over a log with crows cawing over my pieces, black wings flashing and fluttering, sticking their beaks into strands of flesh, taking slices of my cut-open stomach. I try oh so desperately to flush that thought from my mind. It's what De Vere wants me to think. Distract me into cowering. I need to concentrate on this moment, of Zamora unconscious by my side, of De Vere standing before me, and focus on nothing but my sword and his. So I draw my sword. De Vere's glassy eyes flash out in the distance toward the lifeless lump that is Balin, appearing as little more than a mound of dirt. His arms splayed like dead wood from below his body beneath the branch that had crushed his skull. I almost feel empathy for De Vere losing a friend. Then De Vere's eyes return to me, as though they now carry extra rage, needing revenge. "You killed Balin," he says. A lie of saying he fell off his horse, and he did, sort of, could lessen De Vere's rage by a degree, but the truth is, it was me. It was my trick that drove him into that branch. And right now, with a man a dueling 10-pace march away, and a dead dog in the shrubs, it seems the only answer worthy is truth. "I did," I say. "But it was never my wish." De Vere stares blankly as if my words were mute. There is nothing at all between De Vere and myself. De Vere knuckles his sword and swings it violently toward my side. I send my blade to meet his, and they strike in a ringing clash. The solid vibration of steel against steel sends a shiver through my hands right to my heart. The sound of the clashing steel dwarfs the clapping of sticks, and it quickly reminds me that these are not carved pieces of wood, not shards of timber carved from a tree, but swords. And this is not practice, but a fight, a real bout with real lives and real deaths, and another's life depending on my every swing. De Vere grins over the way my hands tremble from the strike. "You and your friend will be joining Balin soon enough, kid." I glance at Zamora lying unconscious on the ground, hands beside her head as if she could be sleeping. Only one calls me that. De Vere strikes again, and I draw my sword back toward my chest, blocking the blow, holding firm this time. After the first strike, it was doubtful I possessed the same steel inside me as the sword, but after defending that strike, it becomes clear there is some strength fortifying my bones. David taught me well. This battle can be fought. Perhaps sensing my confidence, De Vere makes a show of arcing his sword slowly across the line of my throat, snickering as if intending to foreshadow that is the place of his next strike. Suddenly, De Vere fakes right and then swings high to my head, which forces me to step back and throw my sword forward and meet his blade midair. The swords sing as if in a musical, and De Vere's glassy eyes take my full focus, stabbing uncertain fear into my soul. He swings a fist for my cheekbone, but I slip under him and with a spin swipe at his legs. He fences back and steadies on the ground, avoiding the blow. But the moonlight quickly shows the attack wasn't quite avoided. A cut is revealed. The blade sliced a slit through the inner side of his pants and slashed his skin. My skills are a match for him. De Vere glances at the wound, expression hardens. When fighting for another, I tell him, one finds added strength. I arc the sword and gather breath and composure, the tip of my boot swiveling steady on the grass. And then we circle, toe over toe, slow steps. De Vere takes a few sleek paces in a sweep, his eyes concentrating, and then splitting his focus, he throws a glance toward me, then another toward Zamora. He creeps closer to Zamora, still lying unconscious. The heartless man is going to attack her. It's too risky to merely wait. I launch myself toward the man, swinging steel like a samurai. Deivari grunts and parries my sword down hard, its tip smacking the ground. The sword jolts from my hands, and as I reach down for it, Deivari pummels a fist into my ribs with a force, as if his hand could bust my ribcage apart and grab hold of my heart. My whole ribcage quivers, and I fall back with boots slipping from the ground. He delivers a punch to my jaw, and my head rocks back and collides into a tree trunk. Pure blunt force racks my skull. Red flashes explode across my vision like a firecracker. Chapter 20. Deivari shuffles around by his horse, the image of the man and his steed a disturbed mass of shadow. He takes something, dangling in his hands, and moves toward me quietly through the grass. His body appearing in shadows and glooms. My head feels it's adrift in the clouds far above the line of trees, and stifles my movement, and everything around me is a blur of obscurities and sounds. Deivari shoves me into the cold, wet ground, and quickly ties my hands behind my back with what burns like a length of a rope. This time I lie not naked in the back room of the brasserie, but clothed, lying in peril, deep in the Corsica woods. The cold blades scrub against my face as Deivari gathers my sword. He's going to sink the steel into my belly. The former gendarme arcs the sword in a menacing taunt, then tosses it away, releasing a faint whir-whir of the blade whipping through the wind, followed by a crash into the faraway trees. But the man still possesses his own sword. Coughing in fits that taste of blood, I struggle up to my knees and my body sways, head throbbing and pulsing like it contains blood that aches to bleed out of my ears. The encircling spread of oaks and pines and sycamores are a haze of one giant mangled garden, but soon my focus begins to clear, showing Zamora sitting dazed against a tree, head on a slant, drifting to and fro in incremental shifts. Deivari's boots slide through the grassland like a serpent on the hunt. He stands right before me, boots of worn leather for a man worn thin of mercy. "Your sword is long gone," he says, "and if you don't cough up that compass, kid, you and your girl will be coughing up gushes of blood." He places the tip of his sword under my chin, the icy steel making me think of a crow's cold demeanor, empty, without soul, the bird would eat me without hesitation. But David's voice pulls apart the morbid thought and speaks to me out of the gloom. "Don't let your mind wander, Link. Control your mind. Use it." My focus shifts from the blade and the aftermath of the crow's feasting and steadies on the man holding the sword. What could affect Deivari, affect his mind to the point of backing off? The violin. The soulful way he played it, and Vani, and the solemn way he spoke her name. "Vani," I squeeze out through my lips and peer into his eyes to try embed her image into his deepest cognitions. Would she want this? Deivari's eyes fall, as if from a great height, into a pit of black expression. He thumps his knee into my ribs. Pain returns to my body in a series of internal explosions, knocking me upon my side. "Don't you mention her name, boy," Deivari says. "A wound for a wound." I cough hard, fighting for every breath that's salted with blood. Deivari marches back and forth in heavy stride, breathing densely, trapped between the choice of killing us or living up to the love of his woman. My ribs burn a rasping heat, body aching to hunker up and crouch into a protective huddle, but it is not time to be controlled by my body. Stretching out the pain in my stomach, I scrape one boot forward and manage to kneel and say to him, "She wouldn't want you to kill two innocent people." Deivari sways his sword past my eyes, as if threatening to poke them out. "You don't know a damn thing about her." His eyes hectic, abandoned. "Never touched her hand nor heard her voice. The way you played for her that night at the chateau, that music," I say. "That sound is inspired by someone noble. Not a killer." "Clever one, aren't you there, boy?" Deivari lowers the sword, giving me a moment's respite, and again steps side to side, feeling his whiskers, still drowning in a tumultuous sea of his thoughts. Then he turns back to me with a flash that indicates he has reached a decision. "That's right," he says, "she wouldn't kill anyone. She hid the heart to protect people. And the Ipianians killed her for it. An unjust murder, but aren't most, if not all." "I'm sorry," I say, avoiding the argument that it may not have been an Ipianian who murdered her, but could have been the other scientist, my father. "She sounds like a decent woman." He pokes his sword forward, ready to dig out my stomach parts. The heart will allow us to kill every Ipianian. Why kill us then? He grabs my collar with a white-knuckled fist. You may be spared if you suddenly remember where that compass is. He wants to finish every Ipianian, not just Venise killer. There's no chance of changing his mind. His mind is gone into the quagmire of bitterness and hate. If I relinquish the compass now, he'll kill us. Well, maybe. Hell, it's impossible, no. Something in my gut suggests he cannot be trusted. Maybe it's his eyes, they're just too out of his control. But he needs to be stalled, distracted to create time for an escape. I've hidden it, I tell him, mustering the most conviction possible. Release us, and I'll reveal its location. Easier to beat the words out of you. He grips my throat with his hand and squeezes, cutting off the flow of oxygen through my esophagus. He raises his fist ready to punch my nose until it sits past my eyes. But with his square-knuckled fist little more than a single arm swing away, Devere pauses as if overcome by some new idea, a fresh awareness. A slick grin emerges on his lips that shows it is an idea of peril. Or maybe beat it out of your girl. He shoves me to the ground, adding to my stomach a swift toe from his worn leather boot. I yield, I say, coughing over the impact to my battered body as Devere heads for Zamora. I'll tell you. But my weak offering is too late. Devere stands beside Zamora, who sits against the tree with her head down. Perhaps the compass hides somewhere on her, he says, and tracks his fingers over the trim of her dress. With hands tied, I struggle to my feet, balance against a tree with my shoulder, then lurch toward them like a soldier wounded. Devere grabs Zamora's shoulders, and she opens her eyes. Her eyes are weary, blinking at the man in front of her. The weakness in her expression fills me with fright as it shows she cannot fight, wouldn't be able to offer a single half-hearted slap. With each staggering step I close in on them, but with no clue as to how to defeat Devere. Maybe I could shove the man. Then he'll grab me by the scruff of my hair and whack me forehead first into the oak's sturdy trunk. The tension inside me builds, an encroaching storm. Then a voice travels through the jungle, "Leave her." I pause my staggering steps in the rainforest and gaze toward the voice's direction. Who is out there? A horse and rider transpire from the shadows, silhouetted on the cliff edge, edging closer. The image would be terribly frightening, but the voice was calm, and it was telling Devere to back away. The image comes closer, until the figure emerges into a horse, its whitish-gray coat shining a little mist in the shades of moonlight. Upon the mare is a man, glimmers of silver whiskers speckled around a set of stern eyes, eyes unflinching. David, I whisper, and he's riding upon Jaw. Unbelievably, he came. He said he wasn't coming because of his knee, but it hasn't kept him from riding here and tracking us into the depths of the forest. He dismounts Jaw with a composed and steady resolve, slowly placing one boot to the ground, then the other. Even his dismount is calming. David throws me a quick glance as to ensure that I'm okay, then steadies his gaze upon Zamora and her captor. Let them go, Devere, he says to him, a voice as solid as the oak Zamora lay against. Venise's death will not be honored by more loss of life. David's katana sits on his hip, the green scabbard catches a slight ray of light lacing through the voluminous branches. He clearly told me he'd never hold a sword again. Will he draw it if needed? Maybe the blade is for intimidation. Devere straightens up ever so slowly, a caution in the stance. He steps away from Zamora. David Leon, he says, running his eyes over David as if he were gauging who would be the victor in a fight. The boy from Gipuzkoa, who rose to become an Apollyon, then married an Ipianian. Devere raises his sword and places one end of it in his hand and feels the blade tip, smiling evilly. Vani was a moral woman, David says, showing no fear over the threat of the sword. She wouldn't want killing. Devere points his sword at David, like an irate raider. Don't you speak of her. There's no need for anyone to die here, David says. Devere turns back to look upon Zamora, who is slowly coming to, eyes slowly blinking. Then he turns toward the river in a glassy-eyed gaze that reflects the running water, thinking, perhaps pondering, if Vani really would want to see the death of the young girl sitting by the tree. Then amazingly he tucks his sword into its sheath, swish. "Maybe another time, old friend," he says, then takes 10 paces to his horse and climbs on its back and with a few kicks of his heels and a tug on the reins, turns the steed away. The Percheron swishes its black tail as if saying goodbye, and with the departing horse goes my fears. It's over. I go to Zamora, barely noticing any pain in my own body. Her glassy eyes blink beneath a shroud of hair as she peers toward my direction, trying to see the person before her, but it appears she can't quite focus. "It will be all right," I tell her, wishing my hands weren't tied so I could brush her hair from her eyes. But that possibility is out, so I sit beside the girl, brushing my shoulder against her shoulder to reassure her she's amongst friends. "Just a touch of blood," I say, eyeing a gash on her scalp trickling blood into her thick chocolate hair. It's clotted with dirt, the blood all muddied, and makes my weak stomach wince. "You'd call it a graze." A clunky truth that shows my affection affected by nerves, and the growth of us understanding each other's little quirks. David starts to approach, his footsteps crackling over leaves. The sounds are gentle and mollifying, but they're soon ripped apart by the hard sound of snapping hooves. Out amongst the shadows, Deveri turns his horse in a dashing spin, pulls his sword, and with the horse galloping, he swings the blade at David. In a moment, David steps back and draws his samurai sword and defends Deveri's strike with a steely clash. The urge to run over there is halted by my tied hands. Deveri, not tiring, after one charge turns the horse sharply again and strikes once more with a swing toward David's shoulder, their swords clashing a clean. Deveri takes vicious swings of steel and drives David toward the cliff. Upon reaching the edge of the precipice where David's boots stand within inches from falling, Deveri rears his Percheron up and with kicking hooves brings the heavy animal down on David, swinging a final strike with his sword. David defends it, a resounding clong. But the earth gives way at his feet, sending all three tumbling down the ridge, the horse squealing a piercing wail through the night. David could get squashed by the horse or accidentally slice himself with his sword, and there's the issue with his knee. "David needs me," I tell Zamora, "but I'll return." With that, despite my hands tied and useless, I get my tottering body up from the ground and run in a swaying canter to the cliff face. David Deveri and his horse have fallen about 20 feet onto a narrow sandbar by the riverbank, the black-gray Percheron standing stagnant behind them, perhaps frozen in shock. The water flows past as if unaffected by the battle of two lives, the white cliff face rising jaggedly on the opposing side. Deveri crawls to his hands and knees as if searching the sand for a lost coin, then struggles upright in a bruised fashion. David scraps to his feet in like manner, grimacing and favoring his knee. "David needs me down there. No idea how I'll be any help, but trying is a must." It seems safest to sit and slide down the cliff toward them, scraping my butt along the earthy cliff face and the scatters of jagged rocks that jut into my backside. Deveri wipes blood from his lip with a slick grin that seems to reveal he enjoyed the pain of the fall, enjoying the fight. The river flowing in a gentle cascade beside them is the only sound until crows caw from over the river, disturbed by the fall and the earlier clashing of steel. Deveri, having finally steadied, glares at David. "I'm finding the heart." David does not take his eyes off him. "The heart cannot bring back Vini." "Every moment all I feel is pain," Deveri says. "My Vini killed by those she fought to protect. Wiping out the Ipianian race will bring me peace." With my boots sliding as silently as possible, I slip down the remainder way to the bank, and with furtive steps, gather myself beside Deveri's Percheron, blocking me from Deveri's view. I begin yanking on my rope, trying to untie my hands. "Come on, stupid rope, undo." Deveri takes measured steps toward David, boots steady in the sand and seemingly having the advantage over David with his further wounded knee. However, David does not back away as he is approached. He gathers his feet, wielding his blade. Deveri stands so close that there is barely a fist throw between them, then raises his sword. "Betrayer," he shouts, and with a powerful swing thrusts at David. David retracts his sword in defense, and the sounds of clashing steel echoes along the river, reigniting the cause of the crows. The combatants duck and weave with extraordinary skill, swords flashing streaks of silver as the moon strikes the cold blades. As it appears David is tiring, breathing heavily and slowing on his wounded leg, Deveri strikes down hard toward his neck, David blocks it but stumbles, the knee taking its toll. Devere's eyes flit toward David's knee. Devere strikes again with a ferocious grimace. David parries, and their swords clang and sing a terrible song. Despite my hands being secured, I consider charging forth and kicking Devere, but soon it becomes clear that David is the superior swordsman. Sliding beneath Devere's blade with a slick swirl of his sword is all David needs to throw Devere off balance, which David takes advantage of, and flourish attacks, sweeping his sword viciously to one side, sending Devere Laverne tripping back with unbalanced shuffles of his boots. David braces to run his sword through him. Then he flips his sword and grabs the hilt and smacks the butt of it into Devere's face with a clack, clouding him down into the sandy riverbank. "Give it up, Devere," David says, voice interrupted by rasping breath. "She'd never want anyone harmed." Anxious tension sweeps over the sandbar as both men gauge one another. Devere sits in the sand, sand dusted over his pants, with his hand still grasping his sword. David's chest rises and falls. When lesser men would choose to finish their opponent, David extends his hand. David offers mercy at a time so crucial, his honor leading him heroically. Devere ponders the hand, then looks away. The moonlight glints upon his eyes, revealing he is thinking about whether to get up and battle, or leave and forget this whole mess, but it appears his thoughts are as cloudy as those that brought the earlier rain. David would know Devere's pondering his next move too, that he could be preparing to strike. He takes a chance on him and allows Devere to stand, perhaps their old friendship breaking through hate. Devere wipes blood from his nose, the aftermath of the blunt impact from the hilt to the face. He lowers his sword until the tip scuffs the sand, a calmness fallen upon his vicious face. For the briefest moment, it's like he's going to be moved by Vinny, his love from the past, his beloved, and walk away. But suddenly, he is overtaken by rage. Devere snaps forward and kicks the heel of his boot into David's knee. The crunch ricochets up the sandbar, shattering David's knee along with my heart. Devere grows in anger. Vinny is not around for me to respect her wishes. With David weakened, Devere boots him in the chest, sending David slapping back against the face of the cliff, jagged rocks smashing into his body, and he drops his sword. The sight of seeing David's sword leave his hand is unnerving. Devere boots the katana away, then stares him down. David's hope transfers from his sword to me. My head screams, "Dash forward, Lincoln, sally forth and battle the man," but my mind argues, "But the rope still secures my damn hands, and even if my hands were free, my swordsmanship will not be a match." The katana lies upon the sand, oh, if only to use it to sever these ropes, but a dash over there will see Devere cut me down. There is nothing for me to do. The percheron grunts, a low-sounding snort. Slowly my eyes are drawn to his blackish-gray coat of fur. Devere's horse is right beside me, and sometimes you have to use whatever you can get your hands on, or teeth on. I lean my face right up against the horse's hind leg, taking in the smell of the fur. Then, my tongue slathers over the percheron's foul-tasting hair, as I sink my teeth deep into the animal's rump. The horse releases a squeal like he was scalded by a branding iron. It's a terrible sound, an ear-piercing squelch, a sound a horse should never make. In an explosion, the bitten pony bolts down the narrow bank, ramming his shoulder straight into Devere, knocking him over, and with a flash of his hooves, the steed disappears down the sandbar, allowing time for David to gather his feet. Devere, now aware of my presence, gets up from off the sand and paces toward me, pointing his sword. "I'll cut those tied hands clean off." "My hand offered mercy," David says, collecting his sword and facing Devere once again, favoring his knee but standing strong. Devere stops his march toward me and turns around. David takes a double-handed grip of the katana, pointing it directly at Devere's chest. David's leading leg straightens, the other resting back at a slight angle, posing in the posture of a samurai. "You should have accepted." Devere arcs his sword, until he braces into a stance similar to the statues of the stone warriors on the Chateau Bridge. The two men stand off at no more than 10 paces, facing each other alongside the river. The way they regard one another shows this fight will be ending, with only one of them standing. Devere puffs hard, then runs at David. David moves toward him, composed. They swiftly cross paths, and there's a flash of steel and a clang, a slice of blood as the two men exchange blows and come to stand on opposite sides of the bank, once again 10 paces apart. David holds his sword forward with one hand while the other grabs his shoulder, blood dripping through his fingers. Oh hell. He's wounded. The sight of blood dripping from David is something that would have gratified me during our first few weeks together, maybe coming from his nose after I punched it. But seeing the red seeping from his body now, I can only hope it is not dripping from anywhere other than his arm. Devere stands facing David with putrefied hatred burning in his eyes. 2. He spits a spray of blood onto the bank, and the way it clunks out shows it hasn't been caused by a wound to the mouth, but an internal wound. He begins to waver like a drunken beggar, about to fall unconscious, then staggers to his knees, digging his sword into the sand to lean upon. Through his dark brown shirt seeps a stain of blood. Despite all the pain that must be burning through his body, he battles to keep himself upright, the hardness of the man evident. He stops glaring at David, and his eyes jitter back and forth as Devere appears to delve into his own thoughts for the last time, until finally he speaks, "I convinced Vanni." He coughs, spitting up lumps of blood, which sees him wiping his mouth with his sleeve. "I convinced Vanni to join." His voice, that is always as harsh and compact as gravel on a worn road, now is softened and tempered. His eyes drift into closure, and his face falls still and calm like a lake on a windless night. With his eyelids shutting, I believe he's sharing his final thoughts with Vinny. At least, that's what I'd like to believe. Maybe their first kiss, the first time he took her hand and felt its warmth, or perhaps the very first time they met eyes, their first glance. Devere Laverne falls face forward into the sand. It's a soft, muffled sound when he falls, like the sand caught him gently. But it's a false softness, as he'll never rise, never ride another wagon or dance with a girl at a ball. He's gone, but maybe he was already gone the day he lost his Vinny. He lies mere strides away, his arms splayed like dead lumps of old wood. Beside him, the sword still dug into the earth, standing upright. I teeter to David, torn from watching another man die, and at the same time mending from the preservation of my Spanish friend's life. "Your shoulder, it's bleeding," I say, once again a clunky truth, but relief mixed with shock can make you utter silly things. David swipes his sword through the rope tying my hands. "That's why God gave us two," he says. "How's Zamora?" I think of her resting against the tree. She's dazed but okay. "Paludo. A wounded shoulder, like you. Our friends are safe and secure, but Devere is lying on the sandbank, only movement is a gentle sway of his shirt blown from the breeze, and his final words move me to speak, what he said about Vanni." Devere blamed himself for her death because he brought her into the La Chotat Sovereign Council, David says, and Devere's final words about convincing Vanni make sense. But it wasn't his fault. She was a great loss for Devere, one he couldn't bear. A loss can affect a person greatly, in ways unimaginable. The pain that won't cease can strangle, a pain that feels as if it is unnatural, that men and women were never even meant to feel such heartaches. David has lost both parents. Me, my father. And the thought of Dad brings to mind his name etched in tiny letters on the compass. "My dad was the scientist who worked on the compass with Vinny," I say to David, hoping he may recall him now. "His name is inscribed on the eye, Will J., are you sure you don't know him?" David shakes his head. "Sorry. He would have arrived a few years after I left with Nala." I find courage to ask, could he have been Vinny's killer? "Don't make conclusions until you learn the truth." I lower my eyes. The spark of hope that David might have met my father, that he could possibly have answered the question as to whether if he could be a killer, is snuffed out. "Can you climb the cliff?" I ask. David glances at the silvery slope, heading up 20 feet, in little jagged bumps of earth and rock. I'll drag myself up. He takes a step onto the cliff face, wincing. "How did you make the horse bolt?" "I bit it." "Where?" Something embarrassing to reveal, so a deceptive truth will suffice. "High on the rear leg." David's brow rises. "You bit a horse's backside." "Erm," I grumble and steady my boot on a rock for support. "Tastes bland too," I say while extracting a horsehair that tickles my throat. "How did you find us?" "I followed you when you left," David says, reaching for a twisting tree root protruding from the earth, then waited on a rock face by the river that sits at a distance from the chateau. Not long after, I saw two girls drop into the viperae from the shadow wall, then a crazy young man sliced his sleeve off and plunged in after them. David smiles at this, offering commendation for my actions. It makes me smile in return, so glad he saw it, although perhaps at the time it was merely a chance thought rather than skill. Devere and another galloped out the gate, David continues. Paluto took off tracking your scent, and I did my best to keep up. Jaw is still hard to control and had me lost at one point. Why didn't you tell me you planned to stand by? David tests a rock for stability with his boot, then lugs another step, trying to keep his knee from bending. To keep you at your best, and not depending on me. He glances at his knee that must be riling with pain. And for good reason. At first, him not being honest about following is a little wounding, but then it becomes clear he's right. If I'd known David was going to come to assist, I wouldn't have used all my powers and would have stalled in action and hoped he'd show, which could have got Zamora and myself killed. And so the safer bet is not to rely on another, but to take responsibility. A tree root before me, a tiny one, begins to shiver. It somehow feels alarming, frightening. Suddenly above us on the land, thundering hooves quake the earth. Nyig, a high-pitched whinny ripples from Jago. Above, Cheval gallops past the cliff edge, riding the giant red horse. Its red eyes glow like blistering coals, a coat of flowing red fur adorning its muscular frame. Then comes the sound of Zamora groaning and the scuffing of Cheval's boots, and it feels like all the dirt on this cliff face fell over me in a landslide. He's taking Zamora, I whisper, shocked. David grips my arm to ensure that this occurrence doesn't overtake me, then looks me deep in the eye. Take the katana. He unhooks the sheath, then hands over the sword. But use your wits. In taking David's samurai sword, there comes a feeling of captivating a part of David's strength as he is handing me full responsibility. I fasten the katana and its sheath onto my belt. I face David and say, Cheval's not keeping Zamora. A tree root above my head feels gritty and earthy as I use it to climb. Upon scraping over the ridge of the cliff top, Cheval is seen disappearing into the untold tangling darkness of the Corsica woods with Zamora secured under his arm. Having her vanish into the gloom is shocking, but this time there will be no fleeing in the opposite direction. I dash to Jago, who is still hooked to the tree with Balin's horse, the bridles tangled so close the horses are rubbing cheeks. I tug and wrench at the rope and bridles, but only manage to tighten the knot. Undo, you wretched. Panic begins to arise because if this rope doesn't untangle, Cheval may be beyond catching. Jago snorts, his bold eye glaring. He bites at the bit and shakes it, huffing and grunting, and what he's been telling me all along, ever since we met, finally becomes clear, why he's been hating and rejecting the reins. I take the sword, hold it to the leather straps, and slice his bridle apart. It falls in a heap. Jago snorts, a fearsome grunt from the depths of his stomach. We meet eyes, and I understand. Bridles are for lasses. And then I jump on his back. Pounding the earth, Jago runs wildly through the jungle, moonlight flashing through the trees while my hands rest steadily on his neck. Tree trunks and low-hanging branches flash from the darkness as if enemy soldiers whirling spears. Any faltering, and this ride is over. Cheval's shadow darts through the thick stand of trees in the distance. We chase the shadow. With each turn and every jump, Jago hunts them down. Fly, Jago, I say in his ear. Fly. Jago lets loose and takes a lower path and cuts inside, his body extending in rhythm, and his hooves musically strike the earth as if drums ba-dum 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 as his four legs stretch and thump the earth, stretch and thump. Soon, he brings us within a stride. The red horse's hooves spit flecks of mud in my face, but I don't flinch nor waver. Jago gathers up beside Cheval, now stripped from his bunny suit and wearing black pants and shirt. The red horse glances at me with his red eyes, mane the color of reddish-black ash flowing passionately, its mouth bridled and teeth showing upon the bit as if it could chomp through it and bite off an arm. The galloping horses draw closer, squashing my leg between them. The pace is blinding, roaring, shrubs, trees blur by in death-threatening flashes. One mistake could see me delivered to the same fate as Balin, my skull crushed. You decided to get dressed. I tell him above the rumbling of the hooves. You decided to get death. Cheval says, Then with a flick of the reins, Balders his stallion into Jago, and Cheval shoulders me hard in the ribs. I slip over, hanging off the side of Jago, one leg hooked over the saddle, the other dangling, both arms clinging to his muscular neck. Pain sears through my ribcage like they're torn apart. Shrubs smack across my face, threatening to bring me to ground. A tumble, and it's all over. With all my strength, I claw my hands higher around Jago's neck, then pull myself straight and come to Cheval's side once more. Zamora starts to regain her senses and begins punching Cheval, pushing at him and beating him with clenched fists. But she can't break free from his arms locked around her midriff. I reach for her, but Cheval's body blocks her from my hand as if a shield. "You won't outrun this horse," Cheval says, finding time for a snickering grin. "He's got drops of dragon blood." More fables in an attempt to frighten. Myths don't scare me. Jago gallops hard with his full heart, but so does the red horse, and it inches ahead of us. The river springs from our right, bringing up another cliff edge. Earth crumbles beneath Jago's hooves, slowing him down. We fall behind, galloping along the cliff face, along the quickening river. "Hold on, Zamora, this chase is not over." As we gallop on, the river curls and draws away, and then the thick of trees begin easing into scattered oaks, and the jungle merges into a wall of rock covered in clusters of brushy ferns. We gallop between a winding rocky passage, until the rock to our left soars vertically and grows instantly into the massive rock mountain. The great crag bursts into a grassy clearing, a plateau of green. Ahead comes the harrowing sound of tremendous rushing. The river gusts to our right and plunges into the waterfall. Straight ahead is the sudden drop of a cliff. Cheval gathers a firmer hold on Zamora's waist, taking a grip of her black leather top. She kicks at him while thumping into his arms and trying to pry loose his fingers. "Tell me where the compass is, demoiselle," he says to her. "Or you're flying over the cliff." Cheval closes in on the overhang, and if we don't slow up, we're all going over. But I need to catch him. "Faster, Jago," I say. Stopping the horse smoothly was difficult at first and has remained a struggle, but David taught me that sometimes a weakness can become a strength if you know how to use it. With moments left, I slide my hands off Jago's neck. The cliff face ahead. "Jago," I call, never so loud. "Stop." Jago's hooves dig deep into the terrain, and the force throws me from the saddle. I hurtle toward Cheval, who sees me coming and braces for the hit, but he knows not deception. I fly behind him and grab Zamora right out of his arms. As I fall, my legs collect Cheval, and we all crash onto the ground with a thump, tumble over, and slide to a halt, stones upon the surface puncturing into my back. My arms open, and from being securely tucked into my chest, Zamora rolls out, unraveling from me and unraveling my anxiety. The calm doesn't last. Cold wind whisks over my ears as I turn my head and see right beside me the cliff edge. The cliff is so high that it makes the river below look like a tiny crack, a black crack in the earth. Glancing at the drop makes me dizzy, and blazing back upon me is my stomach-twisting fear of heights. My mind torments me, "You're falling down, Link. And taking Zamora with you." My breath becomes shallow and sharp, as if the air drew thin. I try to move, use all my focus to roll over and away from the cliff, but my fears have me frozen on my back. Zamora leans over me, looking down at my face. She grips my cardigan, trying to rouse me from my cold state. "Kid," she says. "Is your back hurt? Can you get up?" For some reason, I glance back at the drop. "No, don't do that, you dull-witted oyster." I force myself to concentrate on Zamora's face. She holds my arm, and we start to succeed in tricking myself that there is no height at all as I begin to scrap away from the drop, at which point my heart palpitates and legs shake and kick like they're having self-willed convulsions. Perseverance has us crawling a small way back into the glade, a place where sanity begins to return. "Where is Cheval? Where is he?" Then he appears. A swift villain behind Zamora. Cheval snatches her away from me, arms locking around her, and in a whip of wind, she is whisked from my sight. "Get up, Lincoln." My fingers twitch, gripping dirt, struggling. My mind urges me at least stand and barter with Cheval, rather than stay down and cower. "You strode over the gangplank to board the ship and did not falter. You dove from the chateau walls and survived the impact, and now here still you quaver, and with Cheval holding that innocent girl, if you cannot stand now, then it's obvious you're a coward. The images of the stone warriors flash over me, the feeling of the katana upon my hip, and the strength of the man who handed the weapon over, and all of it brings me back to my senses, back to life. I get up, stagger away from the precipice, and bump into the body of Jago. But before there's time to think, the red stallion appears and with a fearsome grow of a grunt. It's so guttural, so raucous. He charges into Jago. Jago spins around to face the animal and kicks back at the giant stallion, but something grave prevents me from assisting in the battle because my eyes lay sight on Cheval, who once again holds Zamora captive, gripping his arm around her neck. "Let go," she chokes out and elbows him unremittingly with swift jabs to his sides and stomach, but the king of parody is too strong. Cheval is dragging her over toward the river, where the river drops off the edge into the giant waterfall. A row of big, flat-surfaced rocks lead out through the water, on the edge of the waterfall, somewhat like a stone jetty. The river surges between the rocks, hastening over the cliff. The drop pummels down into a thunderous explosion into the river below, spraying out mist like smoke from a dragon's nostrils. So easy for Cheval to throw Zamora over the edge. I take fast hold of the hilt of David's katana, sitting on my hip. It's time. Then another thought comes. The risk of slashing it at Cheval and hurting Zamora in the process is too great, so I leave the sword in its place and run forth. I jump onto Cheval's back in a gigantic leap, wrap my arm around his throat with my whole body, and with my voice straining, I say, "You're letting go before me." My whole world is in Cheval's gripping hands, and I'm not letting go, not even if my arm squeezes so hard the bone breaks. Cheval coughs from my squeeze, chokes out, "The cliff awaits you, limp." "Let it wait." I clench my bicep harder, the one Taylor ignored, until he staggers and drops Zamora, leaving her falling to her knees and gasping for breath. I keep squeezing my muscles and forearm into Cheval's throat, trying to knock him out and end this chaos. He grows sluggish. Steps falter. There's a pause, then his boots kick back and he starts to whirl around in quick steps, trying to spin me off his shoulders. The corner of my eye catches Jago and the red horse caught in their tussle, braying garishly loud and lashing hooves that clunk on impact. Part of me desires to release Cheval and help Jago, but he'd grab Zamora again, and that cannot be risked. Then comes Nie. A horse squeals like its neigh is filled with terror and the animal slides off the cliff. In the turmoil, it's impossible to detect which horse. The squeal weakens me, as it could have been Jago. I turn and whisper, "Jago." With my mind already fragmenting over Jago's safety, it crumbles apart as someone appears and snatches Zamora. Cheval swoops on my distracted state, and with a whip of his shoulder, slings me to the ground. The earth meets my back with a brutish whump. Cheval stomps his snakeskin boot onto my chest, shoving my ribs into my lungs. Cheval draws his sword, leers down at me with green eyes that want to see my body flow with red. "You're mine." "But the girl is mine," a voice says from out of the darkness, so familiar. And I turn my head and see Aletta has captured Zamora, and with her gold-handled knife that first threatened me in the dark belly of the ship, now pressed to Zamora's throat. "Aletta," Cheval says, voice an epitome of surprise and wonder, eyes a passionate flame as he looks upon the woman, beholding his sweetheart breathing. He grinds his boot into my chest, then steps off. "Aletta Fayette. You're alive. And you mean the girl's ours, Aletta. We're a duet." "I stand alone," Aletta says. I get up, confused as to how to tackle the debating pair, when instantly Jago comes to my side, bringing great relief. It's the red horse lying at the bottom of the cliff. But there is no time to hug Jago's neck, as he rears up high on his back legs and snorts at Aletta. Aletta edges toward the cliff edge, holding Zamora. "Settle that horse, lass, or I'll throw her to the rocks." Aletta glances down the cliff behind her, the sheer drop onto a riverbank. Her bones will be crunched like mashed potatoes. Aletta sticks the knife against Zamora's throat, threatening to run it through her neck in a single push. "Or maybe I'll thrust this blade forward. I'll find that compass without her, eventually." The knife imprints into Zamora's skin. Aletta's eyes are wild with uncontrolled desire, showing she might do it. It was my hesitating in fear that caused that scar below her eye and the scratches from guff on her neck, so despite a terrible urge to charge and rip Zamora from her hands, I restrain myself and think clearly. If you charge her, Aletta will toss Zamora over the edge for sure. This battle needs to be won without swords. Do not fail Zamora again. Not above 150-foot drop. My blood pulses and my hands shake, tremble. But I quickly steady myself, face Jago, and raise a calming hand. Relax, Jago. Settle down. Jago understands my plea and quits his aggravated stomping. He snorts and steps back like a trained horse performing at a circus. I take a breath, a fraction of a second, and tell myself to stand up to this moment. Then I turn to Aletta. He won't charge. Now release Zamora. Cheval eases toward them in incremental steps. Don't let her go until I acquire the compass. Aletta peers at him like he's a clown performing senseless tricks. The compass is mine, Cheval. Cheval extends his arms as if searching for an embrace. But we could possess longer life together. Me the king, you my queen. Just imagine you by my side, clutching my arm, and feeling the pliability of my silk suits. Aletta raises her red lips and then frowns at Silk. Your suits are cheap. Cheval pauses, then clutches his chest like his heart just broke, although it's uncertain if it broke from Aletta rejecting him or insulting his suits. But a place inside me feels an inkling of empathy for him, as a broken heart can be tragically hurtful. But that compassion is blown away as Cheval hardens, trembles, and then builds to a vengeful grimace. You blonde flute, he says like she just tore his poems in half. You will regret your betrayal. You going to cry? Aletta says to the king. Not when my father died. Cheval's face twists, lip curls. No, never in my life. Aletta turns to me. Lass, speak or she's going over. Everything hits me like a pile of swinging shovels to the stomach and back and head. Cheval's rage needs abating. Aletta wants the compass and might kill if she doesn't get it. And Zamora has been attacked, struck, knocked unconscious, and now has a knife to her throat. My next choice and words are crucial. So I relinquish the compass. You can have the compass, I say to Aletta. Just keep Zamora from the edge. Cheval's reaction shows he does not agree with that agreement. He glares toward the woman he loved, fingertips twitching on the hilt of his sword. Steady in your choice, my girl, he tells Aletta. Aletta looks at him like he's rotten whiskey. They killed my son, and I'm going to kill that entire council. Life is for me to decide, Cheval says, and appearing he can take no more rejection, pulls his sword and launches toward the two, yelling a garbled scream. Aletta focuses on him and reels Zamora to her side, her body bracing into position. She's going to toss her over or use her as a shield. I dash forward as Cheval raises his sword to lash with fury. Aletta flings Zamora aside with a rough swing of her arm and then rams Cheval with the full force of her shoulder. He stumbles back and quickly they both skirmish for the sword, holding it upright into the night, a blade that could pierce flesh with the slightest mistake. Seeing Zamora free lights my heart and I move toward her, but while tussling with Aletta, Cheval's shoulder barges into Zamora and knocks her toward the cliff edge. No. Zamora tries to steady, but the rocks crumble beneath her boots. Please no. She falls over the edge. Zamora. I call, loud enough to wake all the crows in the woods. As shock grips my body, I notice a group of fingers clawing to rocks on the edge of the cliff. The girl is hanging on. Seeing her hands gripping into the rocks by the moonlight sends flutters of relief, but that flutter soon melts into a sickening pain. It's like the grip her fingers have on the stones is also gripping around my heart. And if the remaining rocks crumble, allowing her to fall, my heart falls with her. In a pace that would nearly rival Jago, I dash forth and then dive toward her, flying through the air and focusing on her hands clenching. I slam into the earth, wrecking my ribs further but manage to grasp her arm, holding on tighter than I have ever held anything in my life. Tighter than clinging to any memory or force felt through my father's cap. My arms and shoulders hang over the cliff face, my hand clutching Zamora's arm. Then my body begins shifting toward the edge in death-threatening inches. Climb, Zamora, I tell her. I'm slipping. She reaches upward in desperation for a handhold, but the rocky edge crumbles in fragments and her hand slips. The edge is too fragile. Zamora gazes up at me, her eyes the opposite of Cheval's. A moment ago, Cheval stood over me with his sword, eyes showing he wanted to take my life. And now looking into Zamora's eyes, they exude the opposite, they want me to live. So it's no revelation when she pleads, let go. In years past, running to save my life was always my preferred option. Running from the Briards after picking grapes, running from that shaggy briard, Paludo, in Porto Ota a few months ago, and dashing away from horses on more than a few occasions. But there is no running here. No letting go. Never letting go, I tell her. If you fall, so do I. The drop below us is one hell of a long way. At the bottom stretches the thin line of dark waters, but directly below this side of the cliff lies the edge of the dangerous riverbank. Although to face death by plunging headfirst onto the bank is frightening, I'm prepared to tumble down there if that be fate's calling. While clutching Zamora with arms aching and dirt shifting beneath, bringing me closer to the edge, Aletta and Cheval continue struggling, yelling unintelligible abuses at each other like a couple divorced. Then from the corner of my vision, I see Aletta knife Cheval's shoulder, which sends him staggering backward, peering shocked at his wound. All of it giving time for Aletta to cast her gaze upon us, upon me lying helpless on the ground, stretched out as if preparing to fly. Guess that will soon occur when the earth finally runs out. Will the warrior woman come kick us over? No, it doesn't seem likely. Because examining Aletta's gaze, her eyes no longer possess that hardness of a killer, nor are they aloof into her own dreams as always. A glimmer of humanity holds her countenance, and she leaves her position of readying to finish attack Cheval, and dives to us and latches her hand onto Zamora's wrist. Aletta and I share a glance. She was never going to harm Zamora, and is just desperately erratic because she has lost her son like I lost my father. Terrible losses can make you act irascibly. And then Aletta says to me, "You have strong hands, lass." Combining our strength, we wrench Zamora up over the crumbling ridge. My attention is taken by a bleeding cut spreading across Aletta's cheek in a red streak, then Zamora stares up and calls, "Look out!" Cheval charges with his sword. Aletta springs from the ground, running toward the blade. Cheval raises the sword, its blade catching a glint of light. As he's about to slash the blade, she grabs the hilt, clutching it with both hands, locked in a duel over the piece once again. "You tore me," Cheval says to her, while his eyes bead like a lion's over its prey. "Now you're going to break." Surely he wouldn't throw her over the cliff. Zamora and I tackle Cheval. Into his chest and stomach we fall. He lashes out and kicks Aletta's stomach with a snakeskin boot that buries deep into her abdomen. She hunches over and spills backward. A spread of rock from the cliff edge crumbles underneath her, and she loses poise, waving her arms as if balancing on a tight rope. As I hold Cheval back in a tussle of pushing bodies, Zamora reaches for Aletta, calling to her, "Take my hand." They lock eyes and reach for each other, hands stretching forward with wavering fingertips. Aletta glances downward at the drop of death, then looks back at Zamora. Zamora stretches farther over the cliff face, fingertips touch and interlock. "Please do not both go over." Aletta's eyes change, they turn from glistening with desperation to a calm acceptance, eyes that now say they both cannot be saved. Eyes that understand Zamora will stretch farther in an attempt to rescue her, and they both shall perish. My heart plummets as Aletta's intentions are obvious. Aletta straightens her fingers and lets go of Zamora. She kicks back from the edge of the cliff, preventing Zamora from overreaching, and falls over the edge, streams of blonde hair whirling upward as she plummets. "Aletta!" Zamora cries with a shattered voice. Everything inside me should be broken, but shock prevents me from hardly feeling anything, just a spreading numbness as a woman is forever lost. Sacrificed herself to save another. As the moment of disbelief has me transfixed, Cheval steps forward unabashed and raises his sword toward Zamora. Without thinking, I dive into her, pushing her from harm's way. The sword tip slices my back with a hot and sharp slit, as if being carved open like a lamb roast. The earth rushes up to meet my body in a shattering whump. I'm left clutching at clumps of dirt and grass, writhing in pain. The strip of open skin throbs and pulsates. The boots of Cheval scuff the earth in a slow death-like approach until he stands over me, ready to thrust his sword through my back. "Leave him," Zamora calls, and before I can react, Zamora jumps up and throws a wild fist right into Cheval's ribs, sock, then his stomach, and he releases an oof as he's knocked backward. But quickly Cheval recovers and says, "Putting head IP," then strikes the butt of his sword handle into the side of her head with a thunk. She stands stunned, and he grabs her again. This fight is too much, too hurtful, but cannot be abandoned. Seeing Zamora again wounded empowers me to crawl and fight my way up and level eyes with the king. The cut down my back sears and screams, but it doesn't feel to be a deep wound, and the pain can't really hurt me, not where it matters. And Cheval using those earlier words, the cruel name I once would utter, fills me with indignation. Calling her IP like Zamora is lesser, I say to Cheval, that lacks honor. "There is no honor between kings and men," Cheval says, tightening his arm around Zamora's throat and pressing his sword to her stomach. With her secured and me standing powerless, the so-called king drags Zamora away, heading toward the river, and cautiously I follow. He passes a forest conquering outspread oak between the river edge and waterfall, then backs his snakeskin boots onto the first stone that makes up the row of big rocks that form the stone jetty. The waterfalls drop to his side. Zamora's life never more endangered. Returning in flash thought is the fateful night in the chateau when we were caught. How that mob just took her and she cried so many tears, and the best I did was one wild swing at Balin's face which skimmed his beard, and then later fled into the confines of the forest. Weakness personified. David never left Nala, not even when it meant the deepest danger. I won't let Zamora be taken again. She cried enough tears that night. If David could fight for love at the threat of death, I whisper to myself, so can I. I approach the rocks, the waterfall boisterous. Cheval creeps backward upon the stones just as the clouds are clearing, and stars begin winking, and crows caw out of their hidden roosts. The birds seem to utter some garbled warning from their rigorous throats, as we're about to stand on the rocks, on the stones edging toward a giant drop. The stones shine with the water and moonlight. Cheval steps back onto another rock and drags Zamora with him, her toes slipping across the wet surface. One slip and they could both go straight over. Cheval glances over his shoulder at the rushing waterfall. "It's a lengthy drop, Limp," he says. "Best you keep away, lest you find yourself tumbling." The waterfall roars loudly in an unceasing rolling thunder. The smell of the vapor so fresh, and I glance over at the rising mist, obscuring the view of the eternal drop, perhaps obscuring the vision of many boulders waiting at the bottom for me or all of us to fall and splat upon. An unbearable urge feels like it grips my stomach and pulls me from my insides, nagging me to retreat. The mist a haze, my hands shake. But through the doubts, I stare at the man holding the young Ipianian girl. The rush of the crunching waterfall, although still deadly, no longer matches the blood pumping through my body, and the mist no longer fogs my mind, and my focus becomes Zamora. The first stone awaits at the edge of my boot. "Go defend that girl," I tell myself. The hell with the drop. The first boulder is not so hard to step upon. "I'd follow her anywhere," I tell Cheval, rebuffing his threat, "even off this damned waterfall." Cheval breathes profoundly, agitated at my refusal to retreat. "That will be the case, unless you deliver the compass." "I hid it in a mill," I say, creeping a step forward on the slippery surface. "We can lead you there. Just walk off these rocks." He doesn't oblige. Cheval strides back to another rock and his snakeskin boots strike the whetstone. He slips. "Don't fall." Zamora's feet are dangling over the cliff face where they jitter above 150 feet of air. My stomach feels like it plunges down the cascading water over the thought of her falling, but Cheval stabilizes himself and secures them both upon the stone to where he drags Zamora to the final flat boulder the size of a wagon. Sprays of mist rises over them in a gentle shower as water rushes from the river and gushes in loops and folds between the gaps of the rocks. "What guarantees you're speaking truth?" Cheval says. "It's a good thing he doesn't know telling the truth is one of my weaknesses." I skip over rushing water to the next rock where the cold vapor sprays my face, a gentle warning of the smack of water that threatens below. If the compass isn't there, kill us with your sword. Now hand over Zamora. I hold out my hand in an earnest stretch, aching to touch her hand. Steady, limp, Cheval says, then with a shuffle of his body he shifts Zamora cliffside. The waterfall roars in a deafening drone, hungry for a body. Any farther and she's gone. You step back off these rocks and I'll follow with her. My offer seems to have worked. He's going to return to dry land, safe land. A slight relief touches me, just like the chilly mist spraying my face, but only slight. You can never trust words spoken by a man of low character. But it seems my words were also not truthful, about hiding the compass at the mill. Hell, maybe if we ever make it to that stone hut, I'll hand him the damn tool if he lets us leave. It's all so unknown. But stepping away from these waterfall rocks is a chance that must be taken, because taking Zamora from his clutches by force upon these boulders will likely end in both of us tumbling down with the rushing water, spanked underneath its wild rush, perhaps even plummeting onto possible boulders. Backing away, I say, then steady my boot on the slippery surface and skip back to the trailing rock. Cheval slackens his grip around Zamora's neck, allowing the poor girl to gasp for a needed breath, and with her breath comes a steady breathing of my own. Cheval wipes the mist from his face and eyes, then his head jerks in surprise as he glances down Zamora's neck. In loosening his stranglehold, Cheval has also opened the way for the compass to be seen. His eyes light, a brighter flash than the stars. Without a flinch, he dives his hand into the top of her corset, but it is not a groping hand, nor a sleazy grab of flesh. Instead, he plucks out the compass. Cheval holds it, under the iridescent light of the moon, the white eye-shaped ball in his fingers. My heart shatters, suspecting what he's about to do. Cheval's eyes morph from bright like the stars to reflecting the dark rage of the waterfall. I lost my woman, he says to me, now you lose yours. With a powerful swing of his arm, he flings Zamora aside. She goes falling back, but with the adroit swiftness of the prettiest thief in all Achotat, she reaches forward and grabs the compass straight from his hand, then falls off the cliff. Cheval grabs at the air and cries, damn thief. Zamora plummets toward the rising silver mist, and my heart falls with her. As if held by an uncontrollable force, I stare at her disappear into the swirling spray, despite the unbearable pain. For a few strange, lifeless moments, the roar of the waterfall mutes, and my body feels out of myself as if I am falling along with her. Then an unfamiliar cold, like the cold mist, rises and enters my insides, as I imagine us falling together by the rush of water and dying when we smash onto boulders. My vision ripples as if the waterfall is pouring over my eyes, my boots jittering on the slippery stone. I take a breath and gather courage. There is a chance there are no rocks, but a deep river. I glance over the edge, hoping to impossibly see through the silvery fog, and find Zamora has somehow survived the fall and is bobbing in the water. But instead, unbelievably, she's clinging to a twisting tree root stretching out from the waterfall, one from the mighty oak just off the bank. My heart kicks back into rhythm with a strong beat. Do not let her slip away, I tell myself. Go after her. I break from my trance and charge toward Cheval, leaping rocks. The watery surface is slippery underfoot, but I land steadily, then jump to the next giant stone, then another, and then land before Cheval. He swings his sword at my throat, but I weave left, edging the cliff and catching a glance at Zamora, seeing through the mist the tree root jittering and threatening to bust. This is how a man wields steel, Cheval says, clueless as to Zamora below. Cheval swipes his sword toward my stomach, hoping to spill my innards upon the rocks, but I skip back and slip, an inch from plunging into the surging gap of river flowing between the rocks. I balance, jump back a rock, and slide on landing. I plant my hand on the wet stone for balance, and rise once again. There must be some way to get Zamora up the waterfall. Throw her a rope, a vine, something. But first, Cheval must be removed. Steel can kill a man, I say, sliding David's katana from the sheath. But honor makes one. I leap forward with the sword double-clutched and raised, then strike at Cheval. He parries my blow, and the steel vibrates into my arm. My vision is suddenly eaten up when his knuckles crack into my cheek, just below my eye. I attempt to step back and gather composure when he slams a fist directly into my jaw. It connects with the force of a slung plank of wood, flinging me onto my back and knocking me dizzy. The cold rock supports my back as I lie stunned, cheekbone throbbing and unable to think as the waterfall roars. But the blunt pain is numbed by the greater import of Zamora, clinging to the jittering branch that's surely about to break. Cheval slowly approaches, the snakeskin boots emerging. I regard his sleek boots and a splash of wet rock near me. Cheval pauses. You couldn't trip me on top of 100 waterfalls. Damn him. I roll to my side and spit blood onto wet rock. A touch of pain, Cheval says, and sways his sword in a threading slash, the sharp tip shining in the moonlight. Stay down, or you've got more pain coming. Blood begins dripping down my slashed back in warm rivulets against my cold skin, warning me to stay lying on the rock before the next slash causes more blood to leave my body. But how can you stay down when the person who matters to you needs you to stand? Despite the urge to glare into the comfort of the stone, I force myself to stare at Cheval, and for a few abnormal, blurring seconds, his threats fade into the roar of the waterfall and the creak of the branch Zamora clings to, and her tiny voice grunting as she struggles to keep her hands agrip. My eyes then focus on the man before me, who used to be my hero. Now all that remains is him and his sword blocking my path to a girl so precious. With pain rippling through my body, I slide a boot forward and get up. I take a profound breath, understanding the words of Zamora Bonnie, I'm used to it. Cheval twitches, a slightest nod. He nudges his chin toward the river flowing. Slip off the edge yourself, and save me the hassle of cleaning more blood from my sword. Cheval takes a stance with legs parted steady on the rock with the spray floating around him in silver linings, black shirt rustling in the wind, and blonde hair impossibly slick. His face, however, falls into a final stare, knowing Lincoln Jack from small-town Cassis will not back away, and this is the last stand. His green eyes are glistening off the reflections in the water, hand clutching the black hilt of his sword, near every aspect of swordsmanship superior. You have to remove his sword, I tell to myself. Take the force and spin it out of his vile hands. The taste of blood lingers in my mouth, yet I say, soon you will have no sword. Cheval's arms come unlocked, the sword slowly arcing back, prepared to cut into flesh. Spin the swords. I launch toward the man with a swing of the katana, grunting like a warrior. Cheval huffs and rears up, clashing the sword into mine. A resounding CLAAAAANG echoes beyond the mist. His arms and muscles lock tight. I sustain the pressure of the blade in a downward hold, keeping our swords touching, blade scraping blade in a loud grating of steel as they slide against one another. I do not try to jab or slash or attack with a flourish. Instead, I keep the blades touching, the contact hard. Take the force of the sword. I swing my sword in a big arc and circle it and circle it, and Cheval swirls his back in the arc. I try my best to let go of fear, to be willing to die for the girl clutching upon the tree root. Cheval's arms shake and he begins to lose control, lose the rhythm. My ribs rip my side in red-hot pain, but with heaving more power into my swing, the rhythm switches into my sword. The katana in my hands takes control, and I swirl it with all my strength, all my love, my whole life. All the force transfers to me, and then in a flurry of uncontrolled power, the blades slice a shwing, then both swords fly out over the cliff in a slow spinning circle. They go shimmering under the light of the moon as they fall. Cheval watches the swords, transfixed. A loud crack breaks from below. Zamora's tree root splits, popping apart in jagged fibers of timber. She hangs from it, staring up at me in a terrifying wide-eyed gaze that reflects her final ever vision. Then the branch snaps. Zamora falls. Go for her. Cheval lunges for me, but I sock a rock-solid fist across the king's chin. He drops over the edge. Then I dive into the mist after Zamora. My body, weightless. Cheval flaps wildly before me with legs kicking and arms flailing. I spear down the waterfall. Zamora vanishes into the spray. Please don't let there be rocks. I hold my breath, shoot through the cold vapor that bathes my face, and plunge into the river. Chilled water shatters through me like breaking glass, feeling like it's shredding my skin, but at least it wasn't the blunt smack of a boulder. In the cold deep, I tumble and whirl in the dark. Cheval appears from the murk and spins madly out of control until we smack into each other. He opens his eyes wide, the whites a subtle glow in the darkness. Cheval struggles for life underneath the water, along with me. I quickly turn my body to search for Zamora and leave Cheval to drown, but he lashes out a hand and grabs my throat in an octopus-type squeeze, trying to squeeze out my last drop of breath. Only moments remain, and it will be too late for me, too late for Zamora. Cheval's white teeth reveal a grimace, face bellowing with anger. Shove him off, Lincoln. Get that man away, and fast. My attempts to force him away are thwarted, as it is near impossible to control my limbs under the hectic pull of the undertow. His fingers interlock right around my windpipe, squeezing, grasping me to an unbearable point where it's almost certain to force me to open my mouth to draw breath, except that will leave me gagging, choking on a lungful of river water. Get those evil hands off your neck before your air runs out and your face fades into a lifeless pale blue. But upon pulling at his wrists, I find Cheval's grip is too tight. The man's fingers claw tighter, going for the final air-preventing choke. He is too strong, you cannot pry those hands loose, then David's words return, but it's the strength of our minds that make us men, and then instead of prying his hands loose, I stretch my arm all the way back, then spear my hand through the water and punch into Cheval's windpipe. Cheval coughs and splutters, a float of bubbles escaping. A gulp of river water slips into Cheval's mouth, and he seems to scream and then drops me. His eyes stare forward blanker than a palmless paper, knowing he's lost, yet still he refuses to quit and claws toward me once again, grasping at my face. Additional bubbles of precious air flee from his mouth, and then the current whips a hold of his body, and as if by giant death-imposing hands, the river current gathers around him and swirls the king into the deep, his body vanishing in a twirl of arms and legs draped in quality attire, writhing through the water in anger and agony, forever lost in the cold murk. Finally able to hold a composed, calm thought, the realization hits that I have just killed my king. Ended the life of Cheval. It was never my desire, and it feels as empty as the bubbles of air that fled his mouth. Quickly my concern is taken as Zamora twirls by just ahead, tumbling out of control in the middle of the deep. Her hands are outstretched, grasping, clearly showing she hasn't got long. Swim for her. With my own breath drawing thin, I scissor my legs and swim toward her as the current pulls her down farther, trying to take her forever. The torrent rushes me, pummeling my body with jerks and pushes as I dive through the dark undertow, shunted and shoved, struggling to reach her. Zamora's white eyes recognize me, and with hands outstretched and legs kicking as if trying to free herself from the tow, she reaches forward and we connect as I grab her hand. Astonishingly, her other hand remains clutching the compass. The feeling of her hand clinging to mine feels so spirited, like it could make this river shoot us up in a giant hand and hold us up into the sky. But of course it can't. Because torrents are relentless and have no mercy. The current suddenly throws Zamora, causing her to drop the compass. Silence of the deep pervades as the compass glistens softly in the water, the white ball drifting away. Any chance of finding Dad drifting away. Zamora clutches my hand, squeezing it harder, showing she is fighting for her last breaths, all as I desperately reach out for the compass. It's right there, at my fingertips. With a giant kick of my legs and thrust of my body, I pull Zamora toward it. We inch closer. A few more kicks, lunges, pulls. But Zamora has no strength to help me kick, and the weight of her stifles me from reaching the white ball. The grip of her hand around mine loosens. Zamora's movements grow sluggish as her arms, which were violently pushing through the water, start to sway in gentle arcs, and her head moves faintly on her shoulders. Her body gradually falls back, and she begins to drift. The compass with its subtle glow is so close. Dad, I can't let you go. Dad. Dad, I'm sorry. Sometimes you have to let go. The compass glides away deep into the river's dark belly. It glows subtly, like a distant star dying, and then winks out, enveloped by blackness forever. I stop and face Zamora. Her eyes stare at me, gazing somewhat weaker, as if feeling my pain of the loss of the compass. She looks away loosely into the deep, and again the current throws her from me, as if in a wild convulsion. But before she gets away, I clutch her waist tightly with both hands. She is not drifting from me this time, and I pull her back. And sometimes you have to hold on. Having drifted farther, the river no longer has such a hectic pull, and I stream upward with the water pummeling our faces, and with heavy kicking and reaching with one hand, while the other arm clasps Zamora securely, I breach the water's surface and hold Zamora upright. After coughing and choking, both of us finally draw a full breath of river-sweet air. The sound of her gasping is oh so pure. The gentle current carries us as if tender, cradling arms, as Zamora coughs out remaining scraps of water from her lungs and falls over my shoulder, exhausted, her cold fingers and warm breath tickling my neck. Oh, how serene her breath of life! Tears pour from my eyes, almost matching the flow from the waterfall, and suddenly, strangely, cool shivers begin to take my nervous body. The reaction is a touch confusing, because the anxiety-creating dangers are gone. Gone is the brutal and harrowing fight upon the waterfall and its great thrust beneath. And Cheval has been swept away into the murk, so perhaps it's a shiver of shock and relief. Unbelievably, there remains breath in my body, and because of my actions, there is also breath in the girl before me with the pretty chocolate hair. After not so many moments, coldness sweeps up through my toes and legs and runs through my back. But there's such warmth resting with Zamora in the river, my chest touching her chest but not in a sensual way, a way of sureness, a belief in the other, of comfort. And with her warm arms draped around me, I part my cold lips and murmur, "Zamora." The spirited Ipianian smiles, and our noses briefly touch, before she rests her forehead against mine. My unblinking eyes steady on hers, and then I glance at her lips, so close, quivering from the cold. And I part my mouth again, but this occasion to kiss her, but she gently touches my chin with her fingertips, angling my lips away, and tenderly kisses my cheek. "Your aim's a little off," I say, expecting the kiss to my mouth. She presses a finger to my lips. "Shush," she whispers, "aim's good." The pretty girl falls into my shoulder, and we drift along in the river. The cliff rises like a mighty tower before us, almost reaching the stars, the belt of brilliant stars winking down from the heavens, and the warm, alive sound of her breathing mixes with the distant endless rush of the waterfall. God, I want to kiss her. Chapter 21. Kissless. David shortly meets us on the riverbank with Paludo and Jago. He guides us through an underpass, and we all head back on a tiresome journey through the forest to Porto Oda. At the Bayside village, Madame Slibernie stitches and mends my back from where Cheval cut me with his sword, but my body is too tired to feel it much, and the mandragora juice finally has some effect, although there are a few subtle complaints of AR and air, and she also restores my cardigan, and it becomes apparent that Zamora has an unusually strong appetite for bananas, taking all of them from the bowls set upon the tables. Guess we're all a little quirky. After a few days of healing and mending and gathering strength, we say our goodbyes to Madame Slibernie, and although I am leaving, the twinkle in her eye suggests she doesn't want me to. Although not because she wants to keep me as a slave scrubbing her stable floors and cleaning her kitchen, but to keep me as a friend. "Friendship is something that can be kept without chains," she tells me, rubbing my mess of hair, "or without a shaggy dog rounding you up." David smiles and adds, "La Chotette awaits." Jago and Ja stay behind where they graze contentedly in the fields, while Zamora, David, Paludo, who wags his tail profusely, and I board a schooner bound for Parody. The sails catch the calling of the wind, swaying the boat through the swells as the sun cracks dawn over the very same jagged cliff the good ship Silliman Ladas struck coming into harbor, the cliff that sunk it. But I didn't sink with it. Instead, I learned how to swim on my own. Not literally learn to swim in the water because Dad already taught me that, but out of the water, living on land. And Mom will be glad to see that change in me upon my return, after she smothers me in tearful hugs and kisses. Zamora ducks under the boom and stands alongside me at the starboard bulwark, a gentle smile beautifying her face. "I desire to offer you a gift," she says. "Close your eyes." I glance into her eyes, ever grateful of their presence after coming so close to losing them, then shut mine. Her soft fingers take my hand and tickle around my wrist. Not that tickling again like the alluring girl first did on the brasserie's deck, coercing me into following her. It causes me to wonder what she is after now, until she says, "Open your eyes." I blink my eyes open, and after the light of the sun subsides, I see Zamora twirling her hand over my now decorated arm. "Is this a joke?" I ask, looking at the pink and brown leather bracelet wrapped around my wrist. My bracelet is not funny, she says, excitement evident in her voice. Well, it's now your bracelet. She takes my arm and smooths her hand over my wrist, adding a tickle for impact. The pink and brown are decorative. Decorating, not my thing. And don't girls wear bracelets? But I say nothing more and try to smile, showing appreciation for the gift. And a try smile is definitely not lying. It's trying. Zamora packed food and a change of clothing, as well as a leather bag from Madame Slibernie's brasserie. But suddenly, the bag begins making noises, like little murmurings. A talking bag. And then it moves like something is inside, throwing little punches. I show Zamora, and it does it again, another little punch. The bag is alive. It jumps once more. See? Curiosity burns too hot, and I grab the bag. The bag wriggles in my hands as I untie it, and pull it open with a quick jerk of the strap. Flipple plunks out like a calf being birthed out of a cow. But instead of being covered in birth goo and blood, he is scorched and black, and plunks at my feet. The monkey sinks his tiny claws into my pant leg. No, you don't, little creature. I try to shake him off, but he clings harder to my pants and boot. He looks up at me with big watery blue eyes, nose twitching and whimpering. Zamora grabs my arm. Kid, you have a new friend. David, standing firm back at the ship's helm, laughs, an arrogant laugh that seems to dance aboard the ship like the swoon of drunken sailors. You mean you have a new friend, I say to Zamora. No, you do, she says with a gentle squeeze of my bicep. My landlord hates animals. But you can care for the monkey, feed him some bananas. I scratch my head with my free arm, the other being clawed by the mischievous girl. My schedule doesn't leave much time for pets. Zamora's nails dig into my arm, that implies your schedule allows plenty of time. You have a new friend, kid. I snap a glare at Zamora. You packed him in there, didn't you? Zamora smiles and leaves off holding me with a gentle push and turns toward the ocean. I move behind her. When did you stow the rascal in the bag? She sways around and gracefully props against the gunwale like an actress on stage. Her black dress is torn, and a gush of wind blows from off the ocean and flips the split in the skirt and reveals a bit of olive smooth leg, and I look, stare somewhat, and don't even feel guilty. Until she glares at me, and I shoot my eyes straight back up to her eyes, avoiding any trouble. After we crawled from the river and David came, Zamora says, I saw the creature on the bank, lying there with his wet wings spread. While you spoke with David, I snuck back and grabbed the little cutie and hid him on the back of Jago under David's blanket. I let him recuperate in the horse stable, fed him a lot of bananas, then stowed him in the bag this morning. A cheeky grin dances over her. It's easy to fool you. You're not great with deception. Her mischievous grin grows inch by inch until it forms a triumphant smile. It would normally be appealing to gaze upon her cheeks and the way they curve, but it's not a warm smile, it's a smug one. The kind that says this little girl outsmarted Monsieur Jack. Flipple remains gripping his claws into my boot. Surely she can't expect me to keep that thing. Zamora is smiling at the dumb monkey, pulling goo-goo gaga faces. She does expect me to keep it. I grumble like a sick troll and roll my head like my neck has 112 knots and pick up the Barbary monkey, the furball in my hands. He's scorched black, fur fused and matted together in crusty chunks by the flames when he caught the stick. That makes me laugh, not out loud because Zamora is watching, but there is a strong chuckle on the inside. A grin emerges, a big one. Zamora sees me smiling and pokes my cheek with her finger. See, that's a happy grin, you like him. I scratch my head. Yeah. Yeah is not a lie. The sails crack in a full stretch as the wind gathers momentum and we sail out, the water shimmering a golden hue from the rising sun. Again, I stand starboard, leaning against the gunwales and gazing into the deep blue. Dad's cap is drifting forever down there, somewhere in that near-endless expanse of sea. It's cruel to leave me lost and drifting like your cap, Dad, I say to him, wishing he could hear beyond the ocean. And I'm sorry I let you go when I let the compass slip away, but you chose to let go first. Left me grasping onto your memory like a fistful of air. While gripping the gunwale, wondering if he could be the killer of Vinny, an image of my father appears. He's rowing by in his fishing boat, as if he heard my cries. I step aboard his vessel. The metal tholes squeak and oars slap the water as he rows out from the cove, his strong back leaning into the paddles. But the image of his legs aren't whole, and his boots are jaded. He smiles at me with his cap tilting on an angle, but as he reaches for me, his hands blur and fade as he roughs up my hair, hands and boots fading away in fragments. And then I step back into our boat, leaving him row away into the ever-rising sun, disappearing in mystery into the flame. Dad's memory is fragmenting because it was never whole. And those fragments of our lost years are what I've been searching for. But I can only find my present and my future by stretching forward to the things ahead, and letting go of those pieces that have been lost to the past. Because they can never be found. Never be recovered, because they are like chaff from a long dead beachside fire, which have been blown onto the waves, carried away by the eternal seas.
Zamora Bonny. I slide my fingers across my leather corset. Beneath are the rope burns from lowering myself in Cheval's storage room to steal the compass. And there beneath the corset, I feel the small lump of Elias's former fake eye, the compass. Should I tell Kid I grabbed it when I used the current to help me lunge toward it, right before he took me up from the riverbed? If I do, he will want to use it to search for the heart. But that would be dangerous. So many lives have already been lost because of the heart. Some losses may have been my fault. Or my fault. Guff's terrible howl that tore into the woods when I stabbed him will forever haunt my dreams. He was just a big dog. Badly trained and abused. In time, I could have helped him. Perhaps I could have helped them all. Elias, those two men in the cell, Balin, Devere. Maybe not Cheval, but Aletta. Her eyes as she fell, the sight of them is unforgettable. The way they widened and how she looked at me. I could have stopped her from falling. If she just reached a fraction farther. If I reached farther, I could have grabbed her securely. She pulled me up the cliff when I clung to those rocks, then she kicked off that edge so I wouldn't fall with her, I know it. She saved my life twice, yet I never saved hers. Kid aches to find his father, but I don't want to lose another life, not Kid's. I'm keeping this compass to myself. Kid, wearing my girly bracelet from Sybil, which I hope keeps him safe, steps to the front of the boat, standing at the tip of the bow. The bowsprit pushes through the eternal sea as he leans against the gunwale, looking over the waters with eyes dreaming, most probably thinking about his dad. Wondering if he found the heart, would he find his dad too? Strangely nervous, I carefully move beside Kid until our shoulders graze. The tension's knotting my body ease, and the sun shines brightly above the glistening blue. Kid's hands anxiously twitch and grip the rails. I know how he feels, it's such a horrible feeling to be lost in the world without those you love, and I slide my hand over his. When I caress his hand, it stops twitching and falls still, calm. Gently, I lace my fingers through his, and he opens and lets me in. Then grips my fingers in return, softly but firmly. Huh, I thought only girls could do that. The breeze blows Kid's tousled crop of blonde hair the color of the freshest batch of new straw that horses would so much love, bright, thick, and the mess of it showing a young man of heart who cares so much for others, no wonder it is so tempting to rough your hands through it while it's flowing. The messy hair blows and blunders across his cute face that is capable of the most funny and passionate expressions of grace. And his eyes a richer blue than the color of a clear sky at midday where clouds are but few, and his eyes shine with the wisdom, the depth, and the wildness of the ocean. The beat of my heart dances into a pulsing cadence, and I shift a subtle contemplation toward him and whisper, "You're a brave kid, Lincoln Jack."